This is the ICC Men's T20 World Cup.
Well, hello and welcome to the first match for the Men's T20 World Cup champions. England begin their title defence today against us. They've never met in this format. The old sporting rivals, Scotland. The defending champions make their bow, aiming to put the memory of last year's 50-over World Cup behind them. This is Henry Moran live from the Kensington Oval in Bridgetown, Barbados, where the sun has been shining, but the ground staff are just quickly rushing on with some covers, which I don't think we'll necessarily see too much of a delay, if we get any delay at all. This is just the sixth time that these sides have met in any format, and what a setting it is here in the capital of this wonderful island. England favourites, no question, but on a low-scoring pitch, it's the same one that was used in the thriller between Namibia and Oman the other night. No reason why Scotland won't come into it fancying that they can cause a bit of an upset. Let's get news of the toss then. Michael Atherton was out in the middle with the two captains.
Kensington Oval, Barbados, one of the great cricket grounds to stage the sixth match of the ICC Men's T20 World Cup. Neighbours and rivals, England and Scotland, Josh Butler, Richie Berrington, match referee Ranjan Madigala. Josh, you've got the coin. Heads is the call. It is a heads. Scotland have won the toss. Richie, what are you going to do and why?
We're going to have a bat first. I think the wicket does look on the drier side. But as we have seen on this trip so far, the wickets can change ground to ground and through the day. So I think it's been really important to adapt and assess as quick as we can, and hopefully we can put a good score on the board.
We've already seen one game actually on this pitch, Oman Namibia. It's quite a low scoring game. Has that affected your selection or strategy in any way?
Not too much. Obviously we did have an eye on the game just to get an idea of conditions, but as I said, we have seen it can change. Obviously an early morning game today, so it could be different. We just have to be quick to adapt.
Sixth appearance in the World T20 for your team. Fourth for you. You're no strangers to this lark now.
Yeah, no. I think a lot of this group have been involved in a few of the tournaments now. So, yeah, really excited. It's not often you get this opportunity to represent your country in a World Cup. So we've got a few younger guys in the squad as well. That'll be their first time. So, yeah, just really looking forward to the tournament.
How far do your ambitions stretch in the tournament?
Look, I think obviously it's game by game. Focus is on today's game and playing well, but yeah, as a team we want to progress as far as we can, so yeah, we're looking forward to the challenge ahead.
And happy memories of the last time you played England, albeit in a different format.
Yeah, a few years ago now, but yeah, there was certainly a few special memories from that day, and I think a lot of this group were part of that game, so yeah, hopefully we can go out and create a few more special memories today.
Have a great day today.
Thank you.
Good luck, Matt.
Joss, what would you have done?
I would have looked to bowl first.
This is a wonderful place to begin your defence of your T20 crown.
Yeah, it is. Great ground, great country to be hosting a World Cup. So everyone's really excited to get going.
Lots of your players know this ground well. How good to have Jofra Archer back.
Yeah, absolutely brilliant. You know, we're delighted to have him back amongst the ranks. He's been bowling well. Obviously, he's pretty new back into international cricket from a long break, but he's started really well and we've got high hopes for him.
Your batting looks set in stone. I guess the selection decision was around the fast bowling. What have you gone with? It looked as though it was going to be two out of Topley, Wood and Jordan.
Yeah, we're going for Wood and Jordan today. Really tough call. You know, it's a pretty 50-50 call, but we've gone with the extra pace of Wood today.
Enjoy the day. Go
Thank
well.
You.
Scotland, they won the toss. They're going to bat first this morning.
Well, that is the news from the middle. The news also from the middle is that an enormous white tarpaulin has been dragged out because we've just had a real squally shower that has drenched the outfield, but only very briefly. And those England supporters to my left have gathered underneath the stand to get out of the rain. But I don't think it's going to last too long. And certainly when the rain comes here, while dramatic, it tends to disappear pretty swiftly. So then, what of these two teams? England line up. It's a familiar batting lineup. We were known how that was going to be, but as Josh Butler was speaking to Michael Atherton, it was the bowling that the big question mark was. Phil Sultan, Josh Butler opened the batting. Will Jacks, Johnny Bairstow, Harry Brook, Moeen Ali, Liam Livingstone, Chris Jordan, Jofra Archer playing an international in his home country Barbados for the very first time. Adil Rashid and Mark Wood. So that is the side England have gone with. Alongside me is Ashes winning former England fast bowler Stephen Finn. Finny, lovely to see you. We wondered if England would go with the all-out pace attack, and it's exactly what they've done.
Yeah, it felt inevitable, really, I think, especially looking at the way that the West Indies played against Papua New Guinea the other day in a low-scoring game, but they had Papua New Guinea 4 or 5 down and then didn't manage to kill the tail, and it ended up being a really tight game. So I think the extra pace against people or players who wouldn't have necessarily been exposed to that kind of pace before, it is sort of a nod towards trying to put the game to bed if they get the opportunity, but it's not going to be that easy.
And they'll be thinking, right, as Josh Butler said, we were going to have a bowl first. Let Trump blast through that top order, almost get the game won early doors if he can.
Yeah, it's an interesting one, isn't it? Because the 8 out of the 12 internationals here in the build-up to the tournament have been won by the team batting first. So the statistics and the numbers will tell you that that would be the way to go, but they've opted for what they're seeing with their eyes and what they're feeling playing against a less strength team.
Well, we're going to have to wait a little bit because the rain is falling reasonably steadily and there are some clouds over where the comes from. In the distance, there is sunshine as well, so it's not going to last that long, but we are going to have a little bit of a delay. I can see a green plastic covering is being put over Spider Cam just to protect that, and the ground staff are out in the middle making sure that square doesn't get too drenched. Well, what of Scotland then? I'm very pleased to say part of our team today is former Scotland batter Kasim Sheikh. Kasim, lovely to have you with us. Scotland will see this as a brilliant opportunity for some history.
Yeah, absolutely. Maybe follow up on 2018 when they had the famous victory at the Grange. Obviously, this is a totally different format of cricket in T20, but shorter game might give them even more of a chance, and I'm quite happy with the toss. I think Scotland have got a better chance of putting a score on the board and then putting some scoreboard pressure on England, although rain looks like it may play a part in the day as well. We'll have to wait and see, but yes, I'm pretty happy with the outcome of the toss.
The danger, I suppose, from Scotland's perspective would have been had England, Stephen, got a really quick start with the bat, smashed 180, 190 on a low scoring pitch, as we know, and the game was out of Scotland's reach.
Yeah, but you look at this Scotland bowling lineup, especially Weil and Curry, I think, with the new ball, they're not going to be easy to get away. We saw the medium pace the other night was kicking up off what looked like some undulated bits of the surface, so I think just going out there and whacking it all over the place is not going to be easy. You know, the history between the two teams, that game in 2018, the famous victory, that will half be on players' minds as well, and yeah, a World Cup game and the pressure that comes with a World Cup game after England showing in the 50 over World Cup, they'll be desperate to make amends. But when you are desperate, sometimes you freeze a little bit out there, so England will have to be wary of that as well.
Well, that's Scotland lineup with George Munsey at the top of the order alongside Michael Jones, Brandon McMullen, Richie Berrington the captain, Matthew Cross keeping wicket, Michael Leask, who we spoke to yesterday, Christopher Greaves, is Mark Watt, the bowler for whom so much of that economy can be brought about for Scotland, and certainly he's somebody, if they do manage to squeeze England, he will be a key part of that. The fast bowling of Christopher Soule, Brad Weil and Brad Curry as well. So that's the Scotland lineup, and it's a team, Kasim, that they're well drilled in T20 cricket, not least because the qualifying competitions to get to this point mean that you're so used to playing that high intensity tournament cricket.
I think that just comes with the nature of being a Scottish internationalist cricketer. Every game, I actually watched an interview yesterday evening with Chris Soule, Scotland's fast bowler, and he talked about the fact that, you know, they're used to playing in every single game means something. Every single game has got a potential tournament on the line or playing for an ODI status or whatever it may be. So this will just be another game, another massive opportunity. Yes, we're going in as the underdogs, but I think that's completely fine. All the pressure is on England. And I think Scotland, if they can put together anywhere close to their best game today, I think we're in for an interesting game. I think England are coming into this game under more pressure than Scotland. They have high expectations on them. And I'm going to keep re-emphasising that all the pressure's on England, and Scotland have got, they've got nothing to lose. Go and express yourself, play your best cricket. You touched on a couple of the players there. I do think Mark Watt will be crucial. especially with Scotland setting a target. He will be crucial to tighten things in the middle overs. They may even start with him. You never know what they might do with Mark Watt. He gets used at all different stages. But I'm also very excited to see how Chris Soule performs. Obviously, England have got two tear-away fast bowlers playing for them, but we've got somebody who can bowl 90 miles per hour as well, and I'm really hopeful that he can take some early wickets or get some inroads into that English batting lineup and put them under a lot of pressure. Might be a low-scoring game. Funny things can happen in low-scoring games.
Finney, do you agree with that? All the pressure's on England?
Absolutely. Yeah, it's an absolute free hit for Scotland, isn't it? And there will be upsets in this tournament. I'm adamant that what we've seen so far in the five games previously and the surfaces that I'm looking at when I'm looking down from the commentary box at these grounds, that levels the playing field. And I think there will be giant killings along the way. I hope for England's sake it's not today, but it's going to be a fascinating game nonetheless.
Well, this surface, the same one that was used Namibia-Oman the other night, 109, played 109. It was particularly medium pacers from this end of the ground seemed to be able to get some real variable bounce, and some were keeping really low, some were jumping up, and it was really awkward.
Yeah, look, minging. It was the left arm spinner as well was getting them to bounce like he was Joel Garner from back of a length, flying past the shoulder of the bat and almost hitting the wicketkeeper in the head. So it's not going to be easy to just stand there and swing. And again, it means that the playing field is definitely levelled.
Cassie, what would be success in this group, do you think, for Scotland? I mean, they'll talk about getting through and qualification, of course, that would be the dream. But what realistically do you think represents success?
Well, I think obviously you've got to look to win the two games against the two lesser teams in the group. I don't want to sound disrespectful, but compared to Australia and England, who are giants of the cricketing world, and then just hope that you can take down one of the big ones. Obviously, I'd love to see it happen today, and that would sit Scotland in a great position to potentially qualify. But then you've still got to play Namibia and Oman, who I fancy we can beat both of those teams, and then you've got a massive fixture against Australia. Look, we come to these tournaments and we want to do the best we can. We don't get, the captain talked about it in the toss. We don't get this opportunity often. It's a big, big stage. And I think what we hope for is that Scotland play their best cricket. And if Scotland do play their best cricket, I think we'll be there or thereabouts. And we might be one of the surprise packages of this group.
Well, at the moment, we're going to have to wait a little longer to see how the game between England and Scotland starts, because the rain is just about still falling here at the Kensington Oval, where the support from the England and Scotland fans, of whom there are plenty, has been enthusiastic already. We were walking around the ground this morning, Stephen, and it was around about 10 to 9, something like that. Already the rum punches were flowing, the stalls were busy, the barbecues were on, and it's the sort of place where if you get the chance and you're fortunate enough to see a game of cricket here, it is some place, isn't it?
Yeah, it's probably handy for all the Brits out there that the clouds have come over and it's not banging down with sunshine upon them whilst they're enjoying those rum punches at 10:28 in the morning. There's a few there's people populating in the pool over to our right. They're braving the rain, so I can't envisage this lasting too long, but it's a wonderful ground. I've enjoyed playing here, and many legends, all the stands here are named after legends of the game. You can feel the history when you're playing here. And there's a few legends walking out there today.
Yeah, indeed. Well, you mentioned some of the names around this ground. Greenwich and Haynes stand, where most of the England fans are to our left. The Hall and Griffith stand, the Garfield Sobers Pavilion, and the media centre where we are at the moment bears the name of TMS legend Tony Kozier as well. So history everywhere you look, and there'll be history written over the course of the next month as well. June the 29th, it'll be here in Bridgetown where the final of this tournament will be played. The sun has just popped out. I'm sure it won't take too long to clean things up, but this little delay does give us an opportunity to hear from the Scotland camp. Yesterday I spoke to batter Michael Leeske ahead of the game.
Absolutely, couldn't get better. What an occasion, what a first game to start us off. Couldn't wish for a more exciting start, I guess.
Believe it or not, first time England and Scotland have met each other in T20 cricket.
Yeah, so I believe we've played a little bit of 50 over cricket against each other, but I mean, what a lovely venue and what a great occasion at a World Cup to do it.
There's a lot of talk about this being a free hit for Scotland. How are you viewing it?
I don't necessarily see it that way. We've played some very good cricket in the last few years, and I think people are now not taking us lightly. We're not to be underestimated. We've got some great cricketers who've been playing alongside these guys in franchise cricket, so they know what our guys are capable of. And I don't like the word free hit, but yes, we've got nothing to lose. We come into the game knowing that we're possible, they're the underdog, but why can't we go and take them on head first and create history?
There was that T20 warm-up phase in Hobart ahead of the last T20 World Cup in Australia, where there was a real impression that Scotland, actually, they mean business. This is a good team that can beat good teams.
Yeah, look, I mean, again, West Indies have found that out the last twice, the three times we've played them. Look, we're a very good unit. We've got some very good batters, some lovely quick bowlers and some good spin. And in this conditions, like we saw last night, 110 played 110, it could be a dogfight, and that's exactly what we're after. The more that these conditions might help us, then, you know, we've got the skill set to do it, and why can't we go and do that?
What did you make of that pitch? Because it's going to be the same one tomorrow.
Look, it looked a little bit low, but again, England seamers are slightly taller than Oman's and Namibia's, and they might get something different out of it. So I guess it's just about who adapts quickest. They've got a couple of nice quicks which might come on a little bit nicer onto the bat. You just never know. It might actually be that pace might be your friend. That's the way we certainly got to look at it and go, well, that's a challenge to relish. And obviously they've got some nice spinners as well, which so do we. So they're going to have to contend with our spinners just as much.
In terms of what Scotland's expectations are in this tournament, have you spoken about what you're looking for?
No, we haven't actually sat down as a group and actually laid out what we'd like. But I think as a unit, we know we want to get through to the next stage. We know we've got the skill set. We know we've got the capability. It causes, well, people will call it an upset. We just say it's one more big fixture against the big guys, so to speak. We've got one fixture against them first off and Australia to finish, but England are in our sights first up, and why can't we set the ball rolling?
What are you looking for from how you approach this game, how you start this game? Because it feels like a good start could be crucial.
Yeah, you saw that with Ruben last night. The first over caused a bit of an upset in Oman's ranks, and why we've got the seamers in our group that can do that. We know their batters are going to come hard, but we've got firepower in Chris Soule and Brad Currie, who's been bowling phenomenally well, and he's been taking a lot of wickets in the warm-up games. So again, we've got a slightly different bowling attack for them to contend with, which one they might not have seen for a little while. So it's something we've got good assets, maybe a little bit of firepower and a little bit of tricky-dicky, so to speak. So yes, it's good.
That game at the Grange in 2018, it'll go down in Scottish sporting folklore. I mean, you can almost hear the ground reverberating still. It was an incredible occasion.
Yeah, I think that's something the Scottish crowd don't get enough of. That was a huge occasion for us and a huge match, which they got treated to a hell of a game of cricket. And I hope tomorrow is something similar. The way that we handled ourselves on that day to put on the score that we did and defend the total that we did, again, that's something we've got to do tomorrow. We've got to fight fire with fire tomorrow, and all we need is two or three cricketers tomorrow to come off. It could be any which one of our 11 on the field, and we just need two or three really to put their name up and show just how good we are. And again, it could be, we saw Callum and George and a few others on that day.
The thoughts there of Michael Leask, the Scotland batter, chatting to me yesterday on the boundary edge, and certainly full of belief that they can have some success in this game, Scotland against England, that has got a delayed start. We should be underway, but we've got a big white tarpaulin across the square at the moment because there's been some rain. It has stopped now, and so the clear-up operation is underway, and I don't think it'll be too big a delay either, which is good news. As soon as we do get a start time, we will, of course, let you know. Stephen Finn is alongside me, as well as former Scotland batter Kasim Sheikh. Finney, a little bit of tricky-dicky is how he described their bowling attack. Some of those spin options, Michael.
I'm looking forward to that becoming a regulation term on Crick Info or something, the right arm tricky-dicky. But it's not going to be easy for the England batters, and they're bullish. You can hear in the language that Scotland are using, there's none of this, we are underdogs. They're here to play a serious game of cricket and to try and win. And yes, he didn't like the term free hit or upset, did he? But it does feel as though Scotland have nothing to lose, and that really does free your mind when you're going out there and you know all of the pressure is on the other team. And you can just have great pleasure in trying to cause the ups in people's days.
And Kazim, that's the point, isn't it? Because Scotland will go into this thinking, do you know what? Last time we played this England side, we really did have one of our great days in 2018. Let's do that again. That was just such a special and big moment for Scottish cricket.
Absolutely. And I thoroughly enjoyed listening to Leeske there. I mean, if you go back 10, 15 years ago, I don't think a Scottish cricketer would have been speaking as confident as that and as bullish as Finney said there about this upcoming fixture. But it shows you where Cricket Scotland have got to, that they are going into this game and they feel confident that they can win. So I quite enjoyed this interview. That's the way I would want my players to be speaking and be confident about whoever they're coming up against. They have no fear. And yeah, they have to call upon some of that feeling from 2018. I believe there's six or seven of the squad that are still part of that. So, you know, they can drill some of that energy, I'm sure they have been, into some of the newer players and just make the team as a whole believe. I'm sure the coach Doug Watson has drilled that into them as well and just said, look, you've done this before. Doesn't matter if it's a World Cup or whatever, it's another game of cricket against England. Believe, and no reason why you can't win. So yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed that interview.
Callum McLeod scored 140 that day in Edinburgh. He's not part of the squad for this tournament, but there are plenty of names and faces that will remember that day. The weather here, thankfully, is clearing. The sky is becoming increasingly blue and the sun is beating down. But let's get a little bit of a local weather insight from Nicola Chandani, who has been part of our team over the last few days and across the tournament. Nicola, we've got used to these little showers. It's just part of the deal this time of year.
Yeah, Henry, it's quite surprising, really. For the last 5 days in Barbados, we've had rain. And obviously, this is our hurricane season. It's from June to November every year. But still, I can't remember the last time we've had rain on five consecutive days. So I think, obviously, a bit disappointed. But luckily, the sun always comes up quite quickly, unlike in England, where you guys have depressing, very long rain.
We do. We sort of excel in light drizzle. That's our vibe. And we try and just keep it steady like that. Nicola, how was this game from a neutral point of view being viewed? Because I think it's the sort of one that actually is quite intriguing.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of intrigue, especially within locals in Barbados, the cricket-loving people. Because of the variables on offer, I think the early morning start always brings some unpredictability, as we've seen mainly in Test cricket, because we don't get a lot of white ball games being played at this time of the day. But quite surprised by that toss decision, because when I think about the last 3 days or since that game we had 2 nights ago, this pitch would have been under the covers for the majority of yesterday, definitely overnight, and then probably very early this morning. So just given the unknowns, where you don't know how the sort of the bounce will be, you don't know how that being under the covers will affect the surface, I was really surprised to see Richie Barrington opt to bat first. I think Joss has got his eyes on the weather. Barrington has got his eyes on the other night, where it really did get lower and slower as we went on. So one captain believes it's going to get drier and tougher to bat on, and the other one is sort of keeping an eye on the rain. So it should be quite exciting.
So we think, here we go, here's some news. We're going to start in 22 minutes from now at 11 a.m. start local time. So that will be 4 p.m. UK time, and we've not lost any overs as well, because we started early in the day, so we're not going to lose any overs, which is really good news. We did find ourselves here at the ground, Finny, beyond midnight the other night. It was very, very late indeed, but because we're starting early in the day, we've got loads of time where we can make things up. They're funny old start times, and it's going to have an impact on the conditions as well.
Yes, yeah, certainly the other evening it was a bit dewy underfoot. I think by the end you could see the players fielding on the boundary sliding around. The day games, when it's not raining, you would anticipate the pitch to be keep getting more dry. It's very windy here in Barbados. It can be very windy, which also dries the surface out as well. And as the tournament goes on, that's definitely something to keep an eye on. Is going to be, I don't think we're going to have IPL equivalent scores in this World Cup unless someone has an absolute day out. It's going to be more of a bowler's World Cup, which it warms my heart to see that.
Well, I know it does, because you see far too much of these
too many fours and sixes. We need more low scoring thrillers.
Yeah, who needs entertainment with the bat? I say we want those low scoring thrillers, and indeed it was a thrilling game the other night, unquestionably. So we've spoken a little bit about Scotland, Kazim, I'm intrigued to get your views on this England side as well, because the England team, you know, went into into the World Cup in India with such high expectations, defending champions, and it all fell away. And coming into this tournament, there's still these high expectations. They're reigning champions in this format as well, but they feel a slightly more vulnerable white ball outfit, perhaps.
I think that just comes with the high expectations of English cricket. But I mean, I watched the two, unfortunately I didn't get to watch more cricket due to the rain, but the two T20 fixtures we did get between England and Pakistan just recently in England, and England looked fantastic to me. I mean, Phil Salt and Josh Butler from the top are just a dangerous formidable pair in T20 cricket, hence why I'm quite happy to see that we batted first, because I had that fear of them just coming out and taking the game away from Scotland. I had to be under a little bit more pressure chasing, but they're two fantastic players. Will Jacks, I mean, we've seen what he's just done at the IPL. Fantastic cricketer. Johnny Bairstow looks to be hitting the ball really well the other night as well in England, but a couple of days back in England at the Oval, he absolutely smashed it. Harry Brook is a superb talent, but I mean, you can't not talk about, you know, Mark Wood and Jofra Archer. Jofra Archer coming back into the side means you've got two seriously quick bowlers playing in the same team. But I think the really crucial part of England's team is going to be Adil Rashid. I think Adil is going to be very handy on these Caribbean conditions, and I think he's bowling as well as ever, and he's going to be a handful. Fielding as well, watching them across the grass, the way they move in the field, you know, really on paper they should be contenders to potentially be challenging to win the tournament, but time will tell. But yes, the England team are a formidable side.
Yeah, there's no doubt they'll look at themselves, England, as one of the sides that should certainly be in the semi-finals. I mean, that goes without saying, doesn't it?
Yeah, that is the minimum standard now, isn't it, for England over the last 8 or 9 years since Owen Morgan's white ball revolution. It's become commonplace for England to find themselves at the latter stages of tournaments, and it's a surprise when they don't. What I like about England and the way that they've approached the build-up to this tournament, there's been no faffing around. They faffed around a lot in the build-up to the 50-over World Cup. They didn't know their strongest team. They chopped and changed right from the very beginning of the tournament with the players that were coming in. And you'd turn up to the ground and you wouldn't know who was going to play. Whereas yesterday we were just talking about one place. We were talking about whether it was going to be Jordan or Topley, and that was the case today when the coin went up and the teams were announced. It's just that one place. And as a captain and as players, when you're approaching a tournament like that and you know who's going to play, you know your clearly defined roles within that team, it makes you play a lot better, and I think that we'll see a much improved performance from that World Cup before Christmas for England.
And when you say England knew who they were going to pick yesterday, Jos Butler certainly wasn't going to tell me who they were going to pick.
You've annoyed a few captains there, or players, haven't you? Leask wasn't that happy about you saying the free hit, and then Jos is a touch spiky.
He was more than a touch spiky when Nicola arrived this morning, because we saw you last as we were leaving in the early hours after Oman, Namibia, and we had to be back at about 8 a.m. for Jos Butler. You said when you walked in, how was Jos yesterday morning? Well, he was spiky, and I asked a question, and I think that what riled him was it was another question about England's failure in the 50-over World Cup in India. And of course, that is annoying if you're a captain, because you're looking forward, you're an athlete, you're thinking about the future, and inevitably people like me asking annoying questions about what went wrong in India and how it's different now is gonna wind you up. But I thought it was quite telling about the mindset of where this team are, Finney, because they just want to forget about that tournament and get cracking with this one.
Yeah, and it they would be embarrassed, I think, about the way that tournament went. I think they'd be bitterly disappointed with how they played, and they didn't look like themselves. It didn't look like the England that we've come to really love and enjoy watching play. It didn't look like them. This is a different format, and yeah, I'd imagine Jos is at the stage now where he just wants to get out there. He just wants that first ball to get sent down. Mark Wood opened the bowling, didn't he? Bowled the first ball in the game against Pakistan at the Oval last week. He just wants Wood to bowl that first ball, and then they're off and running, and they can just talk about what they want to do and achieve throughout this tournament.
And from Scotland's perspective, any time, Kasim, that they see an England side not looking rattled, that's probably a little bit of a stretch, but sort of in that sense of a little bit of tension to get going, that just maybe opens that door a little bit.
Oh, thank you. Maybe after this victory, Henry, that it was you that got Josh in a bad mood. He was pretty calm actually during all his interviews in England, but you got him riled up. Hopefully that'll work out in Scottish benefit. Look, again, it just comes with the territory. I mean, I've watched England all through the years, and it's always the same amount of pressure, especially on the captain. And after such a failed tournament in the 50 over format, it's until they set that straight and have a great World Cup here, that's just going to keep getting brought up. So I hope Joss is not going to be too upset if there's a Scottish victory today. And I wonder if you'll get to do that interview again, Henry.
I think I am due to be doing that, so we'll wait and see how it goes. But there's plenty of cricket to be played between now and then. We're going to start this game 11 a.m. local time, so in 15 minutes. We've had a brief shower, which has caused a 30-minute delay. But when things rain, it rains hard, but then the sun comes out and everything dries very quickly indeed. So the Super Sop has been doing its thing, and we've got that rope being dragged around the outfield. The last of the covers are being taken off, and we will have the anthems quite soon. So there's probably 15 minutes or so until we're underway. So that is good news. A reminder, if you missed the news, Scotland winning the toss and electing to have a bat first. So Nikhil, the Josh Butler sort of moment yesterday morning that saw some of the journalists as well, the written press, having a similar sort of experience. He was actually quite short in his answers that he gave at the toss interview with Michael Atherton as well. I mean, what do you make of that from looking from a cricket lover's point of view, when you see a captain in that sort of frame of mind?
Yeah, I think he is under some pressure, obviously, Henry, and he'll want to forget and move past that. And when I look at the team and the way they reacted to that World Cup exit, I think they're trending in the right direction, especially in this format. He mentioned coming into this tournament how much that series in the West Indies did for them last year, end of the year, December. They were 2-0 down, and the way they battled back, they had a great chance to win it in the last game in Trinidad and Tobago. I think that group was obviously, it didn't have a lot of the guys here. There was no Mark Wood, there was no Joffre Archer, there was no Jordan, Johnny Bairstow. So it's a bolstered group. But what they were able to do in West Indian conditions against a West Indies team that hadn't lost a series that year, I thought it was a performance that they will take a lot out of, and the fight and the mental fortitude they showed will give them confidence. Look, this is a team that have played a lot at Kensington Oval. And yes, Scotland are a formidable opposition, but I think the biggest game of this group is on Saturday when Australia and England battle here. And the fact that they've played that series 2 years ago during COVID at Kensington Oval against the West Indies, that's England, and they played a couple of games late last year, I think it will give them confidence of knowing exactly how that easterly wind can factor in, how sort of this surface can play. And Butler himself has played a lot of cricket here over the three formats, Test cricket in 2019, won the international cricket in 2019. I think if they can win this game today and win against Australia, expecting them to beat Oman and Namibia, you want to take full maximum points into the Super 8s. It's going to be vital.
Stephen, getting a good start to a tournament, exactly what England didn't do in that 50-over World Cup, and we can go through what went wrong and everything else until the cows come home. But getting a good start, it is crucial.
It is crucial, and I like the changes to the team at the top of the order. Salt, whenever I've bowled at Phil Salt or played with Phil Salt, he's really bullish about how he thinks he's just, well, he thinks everyone's rubbish first and foremost. He's one of those guys who gets out and he's like, I don't understand how I've got out to him, he's useless. But he believes he can whack anyone out the ground, and that attitude, I think, is a fantastic thing to have at the top of the order. And just a few little, the few fresher faces in there, Will Jack's clearly brilliant, fantastic IPL, but the big one that will galvanise the team the most is the return of Joffre Archer, because I think he holds such a big key to completing this England team with his ability to bowl with the new ball and make it bounce, and then his ability to bowl at the death, which the series that Nikhil referenced there, that West Indies won 3-2 before Christmas, the bowling got whacked around at the death by a powerful West Indies batting lineup, and having Joffre back and the versatility that he brings to the bowling lineup, I think he has a massive key to how far England go in this tournament.
Nikhil, how do you feel about seeing Joffre Archer playing his first international in the country of his birth, Barbados, but it being for England? What's the feeling amongst Bajans?
I think at first, when he first went into that England team, I was a lot of Barbadians were extremely disgruntled. They were like, why is this guy not playing for the West Indies? And I mean, you could say the same thing about Chris Jordan. He went to school 10 minutes away from here at the Commonwealth School. So obviously, at first, when he first came onto the scene, there would have been a bit of disappointment from West Indian fans, but it's a great opportunity for young fast bowlers, for, you know, local Barbadians to see what is a phenomenon up close. And Jofra Archer, when he's back in Barbados, credit to him, he plays club cricket here for Wildey. He has his own academy at the Pickwick Club. He's always sort of trying to give back and build for the future. So a great moment for him, and to finally see him at the Kensington Oval. He's missed the last couple of series, missed the last couple of World Cups. There's great connection for even someone like a Phil Salt, who spent like the most formative years of his life here. He was nine and lived here until he was 15 years old. And he sat in that Holland Griffith stand in 2010 and watched them win a World Cup final. So now to be able to come and play, I think it's a huge achievement for those three guys especially, and then the entire team to be back here.
And if you do want to learn a little bit more about Phil Salt, the BBC Sport website and app has an article written by Matt Henry, who's part of our team here in the Caribbean covering this T20 World Cup. And you can find all about the man born in Wales, growing up in Barbados and playing for England. It's a really interesting story, that one. So Kazim Sheikh, former Scotland batter, with us as well today. Jofra Archer and Mark Wood as a fast bowling attack. If you were heading out there in the middle, that's not exactly the sort of duo that you want to be facing?
I don't think I would have slept very well the night before, to be honest. I mean, it's a formidable to be coming up against those two guys. They're both fantastic quick bowlers. I love watching both of them. I don't know how the Scottish batters will be feeling about coming up against it. I'm sure they will have planned and prepared as much as possible, but it's safe to say we don't play against these type of fast bowlers often. You only get that opportunity when you come to a World Cup on the big stage. We don't play against England, Australia, etc. out with World Cups, so you know it's not something we're very used to. So it's a formidable challenge. It's one that I'm sure they'll be excited about, and some nerves will be there as well. But yeah, it's going to be a big ask. It's going to be a big ask, and I think they probably, Nikhil touched on it about the toss, and the fact that I do think Joss Butler has had, you know, one eye on the rein, but I think with Richie Berrington, the Scotland captain, I think he's thought about the way these wickets are playing, and he probably doesn't want to be facing both of those two guys in the second dig with it going a little bit up and down on the pitch. So they're hoping that they probably get the best use of the facilities.
Philly, the other night we saw that the medium pace seemed to be what was causing more of the variable bats, with a little bit of extra height, particularly in the case of Archer as opposed to Mark Wood, but certainly the extra pace. What do you think we're going to see from this surface?
It's going to be interesting. I think you would anticipate some degree of bounce, I think, and hopefully some carry through to the wicketkeeper. I think Jofra Archer bowled a lot of variations in that series against Pakistan as well, so I would anticipate him bowling his leg cutter, his back of the hand slub or his knuckleball, all of the variations. I would anticipate the bowlers will continue to mix it up on this surface. But yeah, Mark Wood or Jofra Archer, whoever bowls this first over, it's going to be slamming the middle of the track pretty hard, I think.
I've got good news and I've got bad news.
Okay.
The good news is the sun is shining.
Yep.
The bad news is we've now got an 11:15 inspection because of a wet patch on the outfield. What's going on out there then, Nikhil? What can you see? You know this ground well. Where is it? I can't even see them doing any.
I think it's on the corner of the square, so you can see where that guy is just doing some sweeping. But yeah, it's unfortunate. I think they've done a lot of work in terms of the drainage facility here in the last 3 months. It's definitely improved. There were patches in this outfield, now it's lush green, which is a huge I think something that I'm very grateful to see, because it's been something we've struggled with in the past, and we've even got some super stoppers in, so thank you to the ICC. But look, I want to also say, Henry, Scotland will understand conditions in the Caribbean quite well. They've planned for this World Cup, I would say, a year and a half in advance. They came to Antigua last year and spent, I think it was a month. They played in the local T20 competition there, so they, as similar to England, have put things in place to be ready for West Indian conditions and what they offer, and the unpredictability that they offer as well. So I think they're going to be up for this challenge.
Yeah, no doubt about that. And heading to the middle now, I can see a couple of figures in the rather fetching pink and blue of the Scotland T20 uniform. And who's that out there from an England point of view too, chatting to a member of the ground staff?
It's Joss Butler. I'm just wondering whether the wet patch is on the wicket. Though you can see the players are coming and just tapping on a very good length outside the off stump. It looks as though there's a pretty dense patch of wet there. It's not often all the players just come wandering out. Reese Topley's there with a coffee.
You're right.
In his hand.
It is on the pitch.
It's a wet patch on a good length outside the off. So can we ship Darren Stevens in? He'd find that, I think.
Well, this is a thing, because it's one thing if the outfield has some damp patches on it, and a big sigh from you, Nikhil.
Yeah, I mean, we have new covers, so I'm not sure why there's a hole in the most important part of the cover, but clearly there's been some seepage, something has happened, because it's inexplicable really that the entire outfield seems to be quite dry and there's a spot in the middle of the pitch, and obviously it's causing some concern because every single player is now making their way out to the middle to have a look at it.
Well, there's some shaking of heads. The umpires are there. Joffre Archer's having a look at the surface, and at the moment, though there is going to be an inspection at 11:15, there is no imminent sign that the game is going to start. There's not any obvious
we
work.
Play a funny old game,
don't
we?
It's a ludicrous sport.
There's a 6-inch squared patch on the pitch, and you've got 25 grown men just stood there with hands behind their backs looking at it. It's fascinating. I wonder whether they can just pull the stumps out and go two pitches over, which looks like it's ready to play on.
Well, they can't, and I'll tell you exactly why they can't, because of all those things like Hawkeye, TV cameras,
yeah.
They're all configured.
We'd have to play an old school game of cricket with no technology, that'd be fun.
Well, there is the beach over there on the far side of the ground. We really want to be...
the jet skis.
Yeah, amongst the jet skis, absolutely. So the news from here is, though it is dry for the vast majority of this ground at the moment, there is a small patch that they're looking at, and I can see Chris Jordan, Reese Topley, the umpiring contingent, the ground staff, some of the Scotland team as well. Michael Leask is out there. They're having a little look at it. And though the players had gathered on the boundary edge, they were ready to walk out for the anthems. The flag bearers were there as well. We were all set, ready to go for an 11 o'clock start. Suddenly, there is a delay because there is a damp patch on the actual 22 yards. And I wonder if that we can almost see it. It almost looks like it's about the size of, what, almost...
a big spider.
Yeah.
A tarantula.
Yeah, that sort of thing. It's not a big patch, but look, you can see. And now there we go. Someone's got a sponge, and they're patting down on it.
We played a game, Middlesex versus Hampshire, in the year we got relegated, actually, from the first division of the Championship in 2017, where we played at Uxbridge, and it had hacked down with rain overnight, and I was driving into the ground. You come round the corner, sort of look out to the pitch, and exactly the same thing was happening. There was just loads of people stood there looking at the surface, and then the groundsman had a leaf blower and some heat lamps and was just stood there with his heat blower on it, trying to dry out the surface. But there's no easy way, because of how dense and how compact a cricket pitch actually is. If it does get wet, it doesn't dry that quickly.
Well, that's the thing, isn't it? And that is the problem, that you've got to, you know, they're so carefully curated, these surfaces. And of course, there's going to be a lot of cricket here over the next few weeks.
And it's just bad luck. It's on a good length.
Yeah,
it's on a perfect length outside the off stump to a right-hander.
It is. Absolutely. You could not have put it in.
No.
It's almost the famous Curtly Ambrose, where he had put a handkerchief down on a good length. To, you know, that was how he practiced his bowling. But at the moment, it's causing some consternation and concern. I remember that Ashes Test match back in 2017 in Perth, where some water got in overnight, and they were working hard all through the night. The leaf blowers were out, all sorts, to try and get things started. Kasim Sheikh, who's also with us, former Scotland batter. What does this do for the two teams? If you're in the position where you're all psyched up, ready to go, you're standing, you've had a half an hour delay already, and then you're on the boundary edge for the anthems, and suddenly you've got another delay. I mean, who does this favour, do you think?
The Scottish boys. I mean, we're used to seeing this every other week. The images I'm seeing there, that reminds me of every other Saturday in Scotland, where we all stand, all 22 of us, stand round a wicket. And, you know, I've seen some crazy things on cricket fields. And I've never seen anything like this on an international stage like this, on a length. The whole ground looks dry. But only a week or two ago, at a club game in Scotland, the roller broke down and the game got called off because they couldn't get the roller off the pitch. And now we're about to kickstart probably one of the biggest fixtures you could get, Scotland against England, and we have a wet patch on a length. I can't believe it. I don't understand how the water has managed to get into that part of the pitch. Somebody like Stephen Finn would probably be licking his lips, but I'm sure Joffre Archer and Mark Wood will be licking their lips if they get a chance to hit that length, because that looks like it's on a perfect length.
It's only by pure chance that I'd have hit that length, I think. Never good enough to hone in that closely. But yeah, it's bizarre and bitterly disappointing, isn't it, at the moment? It will dry. I think it will dry. It can't be that wet, but it could take some time, and that's going to eke into the time that we can play. It's going to eke into the overs that can be bowled. And again, a shorter game on a pitch that's not perfect levels the playing field, and Scotland, there's going to be an upset, I hope, from an English perspective. It's not today, but there will be some big upsets in this tournament.
Well, for a moment I thought there was an enormous damp patch on the pitch, but actually it's a shadow being cast by the spider cam, and so fortunately it's not quite so bad, but they're still looking with some concern at that little area on a length outside the off stump to the right hand, or at this end closer to where we are in the media centre, and they're still not happy with it. And we have got an inspection in theory, though they are looking at it all the time, in 15 minutes. Matt Henry from the BBC Sport website is with us as well. You've had a little lap of the ground. What can you tell us?
I can tell you it was lively on the beach down there by the deep fine leg from where we are now. They were playing Sweet Caroline there about 9:50 local time this morning, which was very early for a rendition of Sweet Caroline.
Well, it is unquestionably a unique experience coming to watch cricket in this part of the world. I've not seen anything like this. There is a gentleman who's literally got a sponge, which he's put on that patch, and he's punching it to try and absorb some of the water. As you say, it will dry out, this. It's just, it's all delaying.
It's going to take time, yeah. There's a poor chap's on his knees there, hammering away at the surface. I'd imagine both teams probably looking at it thinking, we don't really care. We'd like to just play, but it's the small nuances or the silly nuances of cricket means that until the umpires are completely satisfied for the safety of the players, then we won't be playing.
The only thing, I suppose, that could be a concern in terms of volume of water is the surface. The covers aren't the ones that you roll on. It's not the hover cover. It is just a white plastic sheet upon which two other sheets are then sort of crisscrossed on it. If there was, for some reason, a sort of build-up of water as it got spread across those sheets and some somehow just slipped off the side of it, and quite a big chunk of it
funneled through one point, and it's all going down. Yeah, I'd like to go and have a look. We do have pitch access, don't we? Probably not allowed.
Here comes the leaf blower.
Here he comes. I knew it couldn't have been far away. They must have called him in from the local park or something. He's like a Ghostbuster. He's got the pack on his back, and he's blowing the pitch.
Yeah, well, there you go. And cricket's a ludicrous sport, isn't it?
We had that test series in 2009, I think, off the top of my head, wasn't it, where the run-ups and the ground in Antigua was deemed unfit, doesn't it? They ended up having to move the game to
the
old wreck, yeah. Was there something with, there was the lines of a football pitch going across, I'm trying to think back to this, that were going right across the pitch because it hadn't really been used as a cricket ground. There was like football lines everywhere all over the outfield and across the pitch, if I remember rightly. Looked like something that Pitt would definitely want to try and hit on a... I don't think that was right on a length, but something you'd want to try and hit.
Well, how many ground staff are out there now? It's probably 8 or 9. The umpires are in close attendance as well. And there's the gent with the leaf blower, who is just trying to dry out that little bit. I mean, either way, it's going to be a slightly different consistency, and you're going to be aiming for that.
Absolutely, yeah, and it's in your mind. You can, things in your eye line. It's like when there's rough in front of you as a batter, you just know if the ball's anywhere near that, you don't quite commit to the same shot. And then if someone's bowling 90 miles an hour, both teams have bowlers who are capable of bowling 90 miles an hour, if they get it in and around that area, you're not going to be committing on the front foot too quickly.
The umpires have had a prod and a poke, and I think a resolution has been reached here, because the ground staff and our friend with the leaf blower are now all marching away, and as are the umpires. That would tell me they're happy. I think.
Well, the dark patch that we could see when they were initially there has disappeared, hasn't it? So the leaf blower has done its trick. And pop back off to the park now and blow some leaves.
Well, it's one of the more unusual scenes that we've witnessed here. Last night, as we were having dinner, there was a collection of Scotland fans singing Flower of Scotland, not far from us.
Great anthem.
And we'll be hearing that shortly, I should think. But also, Matt, there's no question, though, we talk a lot about the Barmy Army. It's going to be quite a lot of Scotland fans here.
Yeah, we've seen that kit is beautiful, isn't it? So it stands out, that blue and pink kit they've got. I think they're in the stand, the Scotland fans, round to our left, which is long on, I guess. Long off, sorry. Yeah, there's quite a few of them in there. They've got the Scottish flags. I can see at least three, I think. Yep, at least three, four, sorry. Over to our left in that section, there's loads of England fans, like you get at the Euros. We'll see that later in the summer, won't we, at the Euros, where stadiums get taken up, football stadiums get taken over with England flags with the various teams and clubs on. But there's loads of cricket ones here. I can see a Wolves one over there, is that, I think? But similar, Leeds United, etc. But yeah, there's definitely Scotland fans here. They're definitely up for the battle, I think. They spoke well, as you said earlier yesterday when we spoke to them, Henry, and yeah, should be good fun.
Yeah, well, the Scotland media manager said, if we win this game after the match, you can speak to every single one of them, which, yeah, it would be someday for this Scotland team, no doubt about it. Right then, have we got any more news? 11:25 start, no overs lost, so we're going to be starting, 55 minutes after the scheduled start. So we do have, thankfully, a confirmed start time and hopefully no more rain or other interruptions. Now, Matt, I mentioned that you'd been speaking to Phil Salt, the England opening batter, who will be, we think, playing a really crucial part for England in this World Cup. But let's have a little listen to your chat with Phil Salt. You caught up with him, the man born in Wales, raised in Barbados.
Phil, we sit here on the eve of another World Cup. How exciting is that for you to start off with, I guess?
Yeah, very exciting. Obviously, as a player, it's the world events, you know, which is sort of, you plan your year around. So to be on the eve of another, it's very special.
You played in 2022 in that final when England won, but you didn't play in all of the games in that tournament. You kind of came in through injury. Does this one feel any different?
Right now, no. You know, obviously, I only came in for the last two games in the last World Cup, but you know, it's a bit of a cliche, but it's always a squad effort. You know, it doesn't matter if you're first man or 15th. You are going to have a role to play at some point, so very much keeping an open mind at the minute about that and just taking it as it comes.
Yeah. And 2023, you weren't in that 50-over squad. I imagine that was a disappointment. Did you even watch it? How did you respond to that sort of exclusion from that squad? And what do you think the team needs to do to change that going forward?
To be fair, I watched almost all of it. It was on every day, so you know, it was most of the afternoons spent watching that. I think anytime you miss out as a player, it's, you know, you have to get better. You know, it's not a nice feeling as a professional sportsman to be left out. So I think the only way you can take that as a player is to go and work on, you know, because you get the feedback and what they think you can do better and what you know you can do better. So it's just about working on that and then coming back stronger.
Yeah. Were you watching that at home? Was it tough to watch?
I don't know. You know, I felt for the boys that were out there at the time. But you know, World Cups are tough. That's how it is. That's the reality of it. So you know, I reckon I would have watched most of the competition, not every ball, but a lot of it, all teams.
And this one, obviously, there's talk about England wanting to put things right that went on last year in India. And you look at the lineup, there are a lot of players the same, but there are people like yourself, like Will Jacks, Jofra coming back, who had a bit of a fresh look to the team. Does that add any sort of pressure onto you in being someone that people are looking to take this new era of white ball cricket forward?
Certainly not from my point of view. You know, I don't think too many people will be looking back to the last 50 over World Cup. You know, it's the T20 World Cup and we're defending champions, so you know, we've got to go there, we've got a point to prove. You know, hopefully we, you know, we're going there to win, so hopefully that's exactly what we do.
Yeah. And for you, going back to Barbados in particular, a place where you spent a large part of your childhood, isn't it? That must be pretty special for you. Can you just talk us through what that'll be like?
Yeah, it is. I made my T20 debut at Kensington Oval. You know, I'm very fond of the place. You know, it's top two favourite grounds to play, Kensington Oval. So, you know, I'm looking forward to going back, but more importantly, looking forward to the challenge of a World Cup more than anything else.
Yeah. You were there in 2010, is that right, when England won the World Cup at the Kensington Oval? Can you just talk us through what you remember of that day?
What I remember that day is the stand was sat in, Colley came past with the trophy and said, "Hey, I'll touch it while you can," as he was going to press. So, you know, that's a cool moment, very special, you know, for a kid. And, you know, it's always stuck with me, that moment. So, you know, when we won the last World Cup, you know, we had a laugh and a joke about it. But, you know, when we get out there, very much down to business.
So you have spoken to Collie about that since, have you? You brought it up. Maybe a hint at how old he must be now these days if you're playing in the team.
I'll leave it unsaid, he knows.
What are your other memories of playing cricket and growing up in the Caribbean?
God, there's loads. You know, played with Joff from a very young age. So, you know, it's nice to have him, you know, back in the setup. You know, hopefully he stays injury free for as long as possible, because we know how good he is. He's one of the best in the world, and you know, he's a massive asset to any side. So I think we're all really pleased to have him back. So playing with him, I think we would have been 11 or 12. You know, so it's awesome being back with him. But just, you know, memories that you have as a kid playing any sport, you know, whether it's cricket or football, you know, you just enjoy it. And you know, that's something that when I'm at my best, I take into my game, you know, the enjoyment factor. So hopefully going back over there, you know, get a few memories going again, I suppose.
Yeah. So was that club cricket playing with Joffre, I imagine, and what was he like then? Was he as good and as threatening a fastballer to face then? What were the rivalry or friendship between the two of you like? What was that like?
Yeah, he was involved in everything. So he's he'd take the new ball, bowl seamers, then he'd come back later on and bowl leggies, and then last 10-15 overs he'd be whinging for the gloves off me. So normally I'd field for the last bit or have a bowl, and he'd be keeping, so he'd do it all. he just wanted to do everything.
Yeah. And I think I'm right in saying that your brother's a tennis coach, is that the right? Was sport always the thing for the both of you growing up?
Yeah, it was. You know, whatever we were doing, there was an element of competition to it. God, I didn't expect you to know that. But yeah, whatever we did, and you know, he was one of the more ruthless older brothers that you get. You know, there were no our follies. So yeah, I think that's also been a big part of sort of shaping me as a cricketer more than anything else. Yeah, he never really held back too much.
Yeah. Was there any crossover with you trying the tennis and him trying the cricket?
I never really got into tennis, to be honest. I didn't like the... I played a couple of tournaments, but it was... I couldn't get on with the, you know, sort of the non-team element. I always enjoyed playing team sport more than anything else. I never really got on with tennis.
Yeah. And throw it forward to the last few months. You've obviously been away at the IPL, which must have been strange for you, I imagine, because 5 months ago you didn't even have a team this year for the tournament, and then you end up at Kolkata having a brilliant tournament. Go back to the very start of that. When did you first find out that you were going to be heading over there this season?
I can't remember exactly when I found out, but when it was KKR, you know, I jumped at the opportunity. You know, they're a great franchise, a successful franchise, and with going into that dressing room, the people that were there, and, you know, Gambier, you know, just to name one, but it's such a good dressing room, great coaches, international coaches, brilliant as well, Tendo and Crowey. They were, so it was a good learning experience more than anything else. You know, and also getting to play with some of the lads that I did, Sunil especially, a hell of a cricketer, economy of seven and almost 500 runs before the playoffs. So he's, you know, it was good to be a part of that setup.
Were there any particular bonds you made maybe with Sunil while opening the batting together, or with other players in that squad? How did you fit into that dressing room?
To be fair, I fit in quite well. I knew most of them. Starkey was the only unknown, but he's a great fella. You know, Dre, I've played with before, and Sonny, you know, he was sort of a mate before that. So, you know, it happened very easily, very, very easily. And, yeah, I spoke about, you know, the enjoyment factor being a big thing, but it was very easy, you know, to enjoy myself out there with the group that we had.
How did you deal with the madness that comes with the IPL, or the just the craziness of the crowds, the sort of everything that comes with the IPL, the extra responsibilities on a player and all that?
Oh, same as everyone else. You just take it in, enjoy it for what it is. You know, there's Joffre.
Didn't even have to look and you know who it was.
Yeah. Yeah, you just sort of take it in and enjoy it for what it is. You know, it's a bit of a different beast. We all know that. More than anything else, you enjoy playing in front of those crowds. There's a couple of leagues where you get those sort of numbers to a game, but it is different. Yeah.
The one thing I was wondering, how do you keep up with Man City while you're over there?
It's tough. There are a few late bedtimes going on. You're up till all hours, but then luckily the games don't start till, you know, 7:30, and you don't get back to the hotel till 1 or 2, so you sort of, your body clock switches almost to English time, so it's actually not as hard as you'd think.
Yeah. We'll come to the footballing rivalry in the England dressing room in a second, but did you manage to get any of those KKR players into City and supporting Pep Guardiola or anything like that?
Nah, I didn't. More than anything else, there were a lot of United fans, which I don't quite understand, being honest with you. The lads follow it quite a lot, to be fair. They're always watching the football, you know, in the early hours of the morning. But no, there are no converts.
Yeah. Now, I understand that you watched Sunday the Premier League title being won at Johnny Bairstow's house on a barbecue. What was the atmosphere there? Were you away from the rest of the boys, concentrating on the TV? How'd it go on?
I sort of dipped in and out. We went 2 up, and then I thought, right, I'll go back outside. And then they got one back, and then I just sort of had an eye on it from the outside. I didn't really want to ride the wave too much. I was having a good time at his barbecue. I didn't want to ruin it for myself.
Because I think I'm right in saying that you've been away to Tranmere away, and in the darker days as far as Man City, shall we say, and the number 61 on your shirt is another reference to City, is that right?
Yeah, it is right. I didn't get a lot of numbers to choose from when I was picking my number, so I thought, could any of these mean anything to us, and had a bit of a laugh with my mates, obviously the 6-1. It sort of started off as a joke, but just left it running now.
And what's the rival? I don't know if there are any Arsenal fans in this England team. I don't think there are, either. But
obviously he's in the test stuff.
Yeah. So what's the rivalry like with the United fans? I know there's Joffre, there's a few others, the Liverpool fans. What's that like when you get together with an England cricket squad and you've got the football going on at the same time?
It's more than anything, they're good for a laugh. I like playing the game where I get to sort of go through all the players they've had in the last few years and say, would you rather him? Like, CJ's a good one, he always bites. I always say, Bernardo or Fred? And he'll say, Fred. And I'll get a good laugh at him like that.
Terrible choice. And when this World Cup's gone on, you'll have the Euros, but you're a Welshman, a proud Welshman. How are you going to deal with that one?
I'll let the boys have the day in the sun. We'll be back.
Because you are a Wales fan when it comes to international sport. Well, when it comes to football and rugby, isn't it? Because I know you've spoken about that 2016 Euros game in the past, haven't you? Yeah. So will it be try and hide away and not listen to what's going on with England are doing well? We don't know how it's going to go, but if England are...
Yeah.
Phil Salt chatting to Matt Henry from the BBC Sport website. And a little earlier than advertised, the two teams are coming out. We thought it was going to be an 11:25 start. Indeed, it yet might be. But eager to get on with this match that has had a delay because of the rain and then a damp patch on the pitch. The two teams are out in the middle. England and Scotland kicking off their T20 World Cup campaigns. And we're not far away from the national anthems. The two huge flags out there, the Saltire, the blue and the white for Scotland, across the St George over to our right as well. And around this ground, we are going to hear the national anthems of both Scotland and England here at the Kensington Oval in Barbados.
Thank you.
passionately sung by both the Scotland team and those around this ground. Two anthems done, and the players gathered out there in the middle, almost ready to get their T20 World Cup campaigns underway. It's taken a little bit of a while, Stephen Finn. We've had this delay of almost an hour, but the players won't be too fazed by it. Cricket's a game that involves lots of waiting. We're used to this, but they'll be delighted just to get up and running.
Yeah, get themselves up and out there. The nervous wait for the start of the tournament was elongated by an hour, but as you say, the players are just all high-fiving and embracing now. The Scottish players especially wishing their batters luck before they go and face the pace of Archer and Wood, but it's going to be a fascinating contest, and both teams will be happy that the wet patch on the pitch was sorted out and they're going to be able to play some cricket.
Yeah, if you missed it, there was a delay because of the rain. The rain stopped. We thought we were starting at 11 local time, or 4 p.m. UK time, and then there was just a little dark patch on a length outside the off stump to the right-hander that they had to get the leaf blower out for and find a way of getting something dried out very quickly on that 22 yards. They've done that though, and so we will be ready to go, and I can see Mark Wood with the breeze blowing and the heat of Barbados coming across this ground, handing his cap to the umpire, and Scotland will be facing the barrage of Mark Wood first up by the looks of things.
Yep, yeah, as we anticipated, both quick bowlers, Wood and Archer, picked in this game. I think a nod towards a few of the games that we've seen so far, the team batting first. If they can scrape themselves to 130, it can be a competitive score on these dry surfaces. So England hoping that the pace of Archer and Wood will be able to blow through the middle order, but they have to get there first and they have to start well with the ball here, because the power play with two fielders outside the circle can disappear. But the most fascinating thing is going to be how this pitch reacts. It's the same one that was played on the other evening here between Namibia and Oman, and it was a bit dodgy. So it's going to be fascinating to see how this new ball reacts off it with the extra pace.
Well, Mark Wood and Jofra Archer have been having a long conversation. Now Mark Wood strolls down towards us and a little high five with Joss Butler, the England captain, as well. What do you think the message will be in terms of what Butler wants from these fast bowlers? Just all out, quick as you can, see what you can do.
I think keep it simple. I think when you're in a position like this, you've got the new ball in your hand, you can overcomplicate it. You think about swinging it, you think about a few fancy things, but really it's just going to be try and keep it as simple as they possibly can within the width of the stumps, because clearly when there's variable bounce, you want it within the width of the stumps. Nothing for the batters to throw their hands at, and yes, send it down as quick as you can.
Well, Munsey and Jones are two Scotland openers out there in the middle. George Munsey, vastly experienced. He's played across 66 matches in T20 cricket for Scotland, a key part of the side that have made it through to this World Cup, and with a strike rate north of 130 as well, he's somebody that likes to get on with it.
Yep, and he's unconventional as well. He plays the flips and scoops, doesn't he? He's a strong leg side player. He's a big lad, and I've played against him in domestic cricket. He never actually scored runs, but when you're watching in the analysis, he can be a very dangerous player.
Well, if you want to get in touch with us today, tms@bbc.co.uk is the way to do so. You can also use the hashtag BBC Cricket and follow the live text coverage as well on the BBC Sport website and app. Every ball of every game of this men's T20 World Cup for you, both via BBC Radio and across the ICC app as well. Brilliant to have you with us. Scotland winning the toss, electing to have a bat first. The countdown on the big screen, it may be, what, 55 minutes late, but we are ready to go. Mark Wood down below us in England's red T20 jersey, hops, skips, gets ready, and the left-handed Munsey on strike with Moeen Ali standing there at slip. Play is the cry, and here comes Mark Wood. Right arm over, running away from us. And a very full delivery appeal for LBW, but I think the bat got down just in time. Shape through the air immediately, Stephen.
Yep, quick and swing. Mark Wood does present the seam nicely. I feel like that hit him right on the boot, actually. Very similar to Ruben Trumpelman's first delivery the other evening. These balls are swinging straight on the foot. He might want to dip his foot in some ice when he departs the wicket.
Well, it was just swinging down that leg side. Not by much. It was not far away from the perfect delivery from Mark Wood first up. 90.2 miles an hour. He's running it again. Charging away from us. Munsey waits. Another full delivery. It's onto the pads. Whipped away down towards Adil Rashid at short fine leg. And I think that'll be signalled as a leg bye. It is indeed. Scotland up and running. One without loss. And as we can hear in the effects microphone, that is fast from Mark Wood.
Johnny Bairstow, I think, just offering some advice for the batters there. Psychological games. The stop mics are loud, aren't they, in this World Cup? You can hear everything.
Question towards you.
Oh, yeah, we can hear.
Center.
Guard being taken by Michael Jones, the right-hander. There's the other of the opening partnership alongside Munsey. There's a deep third, the two outside the circle. It looks so England are going for two slips as well as Jerusalem booms around the ground. There's a square leg on the boundary. And Mark Wood is at the end of his mark, which is almost directly below us, it feels like. He's running in to Bolter Jones. Full delivery, again swinging, but well dug out. Out towards Harry Brook at mid-on. And a single is just about scrambled through. Two without loss. It feels more like an opportunity at the start of the power play, more a case of survival when the ball is swinging, like we've seen that it has done here.
Yeah, I like Butler's mentality there. Right-hander, the ball swinging away, get two slips in. Something was a figure of Owen Morgan's captaincy. He always wanted to hunt wickets. Having the slips in place with the pace and the swing is an important thing to be able to take wickets in this power play.
Wood again to Munsey. It's the one slip. And Wood bowls. It's hit away in the air, but whipped over the fielder at mid-on, Chris Jordan, who leapt high but couldn't get there. And it's going to be four runs, and that was an authoritative stroke that goes flashing away down towards the boundary below us. Six without loss.
Yeah, dismissive. Lovely shot by Munsey. Just plants his front foot down the pitch, completely still when he hits it, and whips his hands through. Wasn't too much elegance around that. It was more brute force, but a commanding shot.
Six without loss. Munsey's on four. And that will just settle any nerves, as Wood down below us just mops his brow in the sunshine. Still the one slip in place, Moeen Ali. Mark Wood, fifth ball of the game, is running in, dropping it short, missed time pull towards mid-wicket, and Johnny Bairstow will collect, and there is no run. So this game, delayed start, the rain was falling, but happily the sun now shining, and it is warm out there. It's humid as well, there's a lot of moisture in the air. It'll be, even though it's a T20, it'll be hard work, this.
Yeah, well, I found it hard walking from the car into the ground, dripping with sweat, once we got to the bottom of the elevator here at the media centre. So, yeah, charging in and bowling 90-odd miles an hour, not easy.
Munsey waiting. Final ball of the first over. Here comes Mark Wood, and this is angled towards backward point. The ball is fielded, and there is no run. So, six from the first over. Honours even, pretty much, at the start of that. I would say Scotland will be pleased to have got through it with no dramas, and that one boundary in there just offering some real encouragement as well. So six without loss.
And only one ball really swung, the first one, big banana swing back into the left-handed Munsey. Then it didn't really swing after that point. Jofra Archer does have the ball in his hand, so the two quickies opening the bowling in tandem, which is always great to see. That wet patch outside the off stump is no longer there, so he won't be able to hone his way into that. But it's a big moment for him coming back to Barbados and playing his first international game here at the ground. You can hear the reception he's getting.
Yeah, there's a huge cheer because his name's being announced, Jofra Archer. And from the far end of the ground, the Joel Garner end, he will be bowling for the first time in international cricket at a ground that will mean an awful lot to him. And this will feel also a little bit like the culmination of a long journey to get back to fitness and playing in major world events. Here comes Jofra Archer running in towards us. Jones waits, drives into the offside, a rather tame attempt at a stop from Liam Livingstone, and the ball will head out towards the cover boundary with two runs taken. So terribly convincing that from Livingstone. Scotland 8 without loss.
Yeah, nice shot, just stood up on top of the bounce, back of a length outside the off stump. Jofra Archer does get a lot of bounce, hits the splice of the bat, but nice high elbow. Still feet, manages to punch it towards Livingstone, who just flopped over it, really.
Michael Jones waits for Jofra Archer running in towards us over the wicket. Nicely pushed away into the offside again. That's a good looking shot. Standing up tall, Chris Jordan hairs after it from mid off. They'll get two more, though, this Scottish pair, as the ball goes out towards the boundary at deep cover and the beach beyond. And it's 10 without loss. Yes, nicely played.
Carbon copy, yes, standing on top of the bounce. He's a big man, Jones, a tall guy, one of the taller players on the pitch, so is able to stand on his tiptoes and make sure that he hits right on top of the bounce into the hard wickets. Kicks off for two runs.
Here comes Archer bowling to Jones, who this time, well, don't bother chasing it because it's flying away square on the offside for four. Lovely shot again, same sort of part of the ground targeted, same looking shot, but this time timed absolutely perfectly. 14 without loss.
You could hear the crunch off the bat there, couldn't you? Lovely sound. Jofra Archer just erring in line there outside the off stump, whereas the others were played with a straight bat hitting towards extra cover. This was more of a cut with the pace and straight out the middle of the bat. It absolutely raced away to the point boundary.
Well, Jones, who started his academy career at Lancashire before moving on to Durham, has played with authority from the first four balls that he's faced. 9 from 4. And Scotland are 14 without loss in the second over. Here comes Archer in again, left alone outside the off stump, flashing through to Butler. There's no slip in place now. Moeen Ali has gone to field at cover. And that will just, it's a little nod to some respect being shown from England, who will not be taking this fixture lightly. They've said that time and again, and they'll know they've got to get everything right. Just a hint of drizzle in the air, by the way.
Great.
In comes Archer, sprinting in towards us again. Jones waiting. Oh, big swing and a miss. It goes through to the keeper. And after 8 from the first three balls of the over, the next two, dots left alone and then missed outside the off stump. That was close to 87 miles an hour. Ground staff are half readying themselves on the boundary edge at the moment, though. I don't think there's any obvious need to head off. There's not that sort of blanket of grey over to our right where the weather's coming from. Archer coming in again. Jones waits, hit away in the air. Can anyone get underneath it? Josh Butler is probably the closest, and it'll drop safely. Mark Wood running around from deep third, came careering around the boundary edge to retrieve it. But it was not a controlled stroke, though two runs are taken. 16 without loss, two overs gone. And Scotland in a healthy position, Stephen Finn.
Yeah, lovely start from Scotland. Some really nice shots. I think when you're playing in a game like this, and everyone knows the magnitude of it, you just want to get those first couple of boundaries away. Both players have hit a boundary. Commanding boundaries, change of bowling. Moeen Ali coming into the attack, which, given the way that they've played the pace in the first two overs, it's not surprising.
England will be adaptable, we know that, with how they approach their bowling plans. Moeen opened the bowling at Edgbaston in that T20 against Pakistan. They won't be afraid to mix things up.
No, you have to be able to adapt, and Josh Butler is one of the best thinkers of the game that I've played with. Always senses the situation. That's why he's such a good batter, especially in run chases. Doing the same here as captain.
So Moeen will come in bowling his off spin around the wicket to the left-handed Munsey. It's Scotland 16 without loss. The rain has drifted away. Here comes Moeen. Hit away into the ground, but stopped comfortably enough. Covered by Harry Brook, who readjusts his sunglasses. Moeen in the red boots turns again below us. Walking past the umpire around the wicket. A sweep is attempted. That's nicely played. That'll be four. Adil Rashid was closest to it at short fine leg, but a big stride forward. Trying to overhit it, getting the reward. 20 without loss.
Yeah, and what we've not actually seen yet is any variable bounce. We talked about that the surface that was played on the other evening, this exact same surface, was a bit dodgy. Nothing so far.
Moeen to Munsey. He's in again. No. This time, there is some turn and bounce, just as you said it. And the ball will drop towards Archer at short third.
Well, there we go. Now we have seen that variable bounce, and it's Moeen's drift in towards the off stump of Munsey. Lovely seam position. He's got such a beautiful seam position for an off spin, and that really does bounce. Hits the glove. Bottom hand coming off the bat, hits the top hand. That's significant bounce.
I think what you would say, bearing in mind this ground has only seen 22 overs prior to today, because we had the super over. Oh, forgive me, 42 overs the other day. Here comes Moeen, this time over the wicket to the right-handed Jones. A little bit of turn, but he plays it nicely deep in the crease into the onside for a single, 23 without loss. Is that if this was the first day of a test match and we saw this sort of bounce, you'd be saying, well, what's going on?
Well, there'd be coaches marching into the match referee's office, I'd imagine, to say, my players can't go out there and bat on this. But it's just when it does only seem to be the slower bowlers, though, the ones that pitch it right up in that last fifth of the pitch, the quicker guys that are banging it into the middle of the surface, it doesn't seem as though that variable bounce is there. It's from a much fuller length.
Chris Jordan goes to slip. 22 without loss, Scotland. As Moeen is in, this is whipped away behind square, and it'll be four more. Munsey again, authoritative with that sweep shot outside the off stump. Big stride again. And the ball goes flashing towards the dugouts and the Hall and Griffith stand, where high up, the four and six cards are being waved. But it is four more, 26 without loss. This is a really good start from Scotland.
That's a lovely shot. He moves right across the stumps in order to access that leg side.
Moeen once more to finish the over positively, and a huge swing again from Munsey. This time it's toe end of the bat, almost snooker cue kind of stuff. 26 without loss, three overs gone, and exactly what Scotland would have wanted here.
Yeah, it's going to allay any nerves, isn't it, the way that they've approached these first three overs. Leask in the build-up was bullish, wasn't he, with the way that he was describing how their team were going to go about it. He didn't want the term underdogs to be used. He didn't want it to be classed as a free hit for them when he was talking to us. And the way that Scotland have played on the front foot in these first, that's figurative, not literally, they've played really well.
So Jofra Archer at the far end of the ground, ready to bowl to the right-handed Michael Jones, who just waits on a ball that is actually quite gentle from Archer, relatively speaking. He angles it down towards third, where the easy single is collected. 27 without loss. That was a pace off at 76 miles an hour from Archer. And I think it's also worth remembering, it's a big day for Archer.
Yeah, it would be. I'd imagine he'd have family and friends here who come to watch him representing England, but clearly the fact that he grew up here, plays here regularly, gets in trouble for playing club cricket here sometimes as well. Now he's here playing international cricket with a security guard just leisurely walking in front of the sight screen at the far end as well.
Always happens.
That is leisurely. I think he's, realised and then just said, I'm walking at this pace the entire time. I won't rush.
This is my pace and I'm not going any faster. Munsey waiting for Archer. That's quick. Defended back towards the bowler. No run. Well, at 91 miles an hour, that was quick.
Yeah, and you can tell already that England don't want to just bowl one pace to these batters. Munsey very dangerous when he gets used to the security guard's gone across again.
absolute no interest in going any quicker. Chris Jordan is now shouting. There's no acknowledgement. And cricket at times can just be so silly. In comes Jofra Archer in the sunshine of Bridgetown, bowling a full delivery, whipped away off the pads out towards backward square leg, where Liam Livingston fields in front of a huge screen, but below it a hand-operated scoreboard where three gentlemen in bright blue shirts, every time the score changes, are updating things with the hand numbers that they're putting up every single time. She's a nice little mix of old and new down there. Here comes Archer once again. Jones on strike, 13 from 9. Archer is in, swing and a miss. That goes through to Joss Butler, who collects it cleanly. Just 2 from the over so far. Actually, it's not unlike how things started in his return match at Edgbaston for Jofra Archer. A little loose in the first over and then finding his rhythm.
Yeah, you can just, sometimes you just want to blow off those cobwebs, and bowling in a match, in a high profile match, in a World Cup, your adrenaline's going, you know, you maybe try and force it a little bit too much, but then once you've got through that first over, once you've delivered 6 balls, you just settle into your work.
2 balls left of the fourth over. Scotland 28 without loss, having won the toss, elected to have a bat first. And in comes Jofra Archer to bowl a slower ball outside the off stump. It's stopped by Livingston, who's come inside the circle now. And another dot ball. It feels like the variation in pace is slightly more dramatic for Jofra Archer these days. Maybe that's something he's been able to work on in some of that time.
I think he's got a number of different slower balls now. He's got a leg cutter that he cuts right down the side of the ball. He has his knuckle ball that he's used for a while. And then that express pace to keep you on your toes as well.
28 without loss. Final ball of the fourth over, with Archer at the far end of the ground running in towards us. Right-handed Michael Jones on strike. Oh, that's quick. Really quick. Hits the batter. It was just back of a length. He tried to wallop it into the leg side. And 3 dot balls to finish the over. Just 2 from it. Scotland 28 without loss after 4. Former Scotland batter Kasim Sheikh is also with us. What have you made of this start?
Really happy. Very composed start by Scotland, considering that lengthy break. That's opening batsman's nightmare. I thought they came out, looked really calm, and they've played, you know, smart cricket. They're not flying away with it, but very, very good start at 28 without loss. Both Jones and Munsey have played some lovely shots. And I'm not wanting to get too far ahead of myself, but hopefully another couple of good overs in the power play, and it sets them up really nice for this the rest of this innings.
I think that's the thing, isn't it, Finn? If you can get through the power play, England playing Archer and Wood here, they would have thought, blow away the top order. It hasn't worked out like that so far. Wood is going to have another go from this to Malcolm Marshall end of the ground, with the sun once again shining. He turns and begins slightly angled approach to the left-handed Munsey. Mark Wood over the wicket, tricks it in real short, that, and that's far too short, signalled wide, and it'll be one onto the total.
And he's only allowed one of these. You get conditioned to watching the IPL in the last couple of months, and bowlers are allowed 2 bounces and over in their playing conditions, but the laws of cricket that are being used in this ICC Men's T20 World Cup stipulate that you can only bowl 1 bouncer. So now Munsey can face these 6 deliveries from Wood in the comfort that Wood can't bowl another one at his head.
He turns again below us and runs into bowl to the left-handed Munsey. It's a full delivery, appeal for LBW. It's more enthusiastic from Wood than it is from Butler, who normally is a pretty good judge of these things. I don't think there's any interest in England reviewing this, but it was quick from Mark Wood. No swing. It has stopped swinging so early, this ball, as it does.
Just 1 ball. Well, actually, because the outfield may still be a touch damp as well, so once it gets hit once into that outfield, you can just lose that lacquer off the outside of the ball, which is what helps it swing in those first couple of overs. And a couple of dismissive boundaries hit into those dry surfaces either side of the playing area also just takes that little bit of shine off the ball.
Mark Wood again, kicking up his heels, running in past the umpire. And again, It's a slightly fuller delivery, and once more, for the first time this innings, the fielding isn't exactly ideal. This time, Moeen Ali inside the circle on the offside, and they'll run through for two, and he's having a little look at the surface, but he seems to just flop over it slightly there, Moeen. It's 31 without loss.
He wasn't all that gracious there, Moeen, was he? Just watching a replay, it took a little kick actually on the second bounce, like a leg spinner away from Moeen Ali's right hand, but still, Mark Wood threw his head to the sky in disappointment there.
So 31 without loss. You can hear the drums beating around the Kensington Oval. And Wood runs in again. Round the wicket to the left-handed Munsey, who's hit the ball in the air. This should be a chance of a catch. Who wants it? Butler underneath it. Butler claims it. England have the breakthrough. The pace too much for Munsey. And though Archer was in the vicinity, Joss Butler with the big gloves on said, I have to take this, this is mine. And he does take the catch. And Scotland are 31 for one, though they are not 31 for one because it's a no ball.
A lifeline. That must have been a decent sized one as well, because it's very quickly the umpire has called. Yeah, it's a good couple of inches, 3 inches over the line by Mark Wood. It was quick. It went right up the chimney as well. Joss Butler, a good catch running back over his left shoulder. But Munsey gets a reprieve and Wood's going to have to bowl it again. It's just those little bits of sloppiness that you just, when you're getting your World Cup up and running, you can't really afford to do that.
So 32 without loss. Here comes Mark Wood around the wicket to Munsey, who swings at that and it keeps chaotically low. That it's almost gone through, not just on the second bounce but possibly the third and the fourth to Joss Butler.
Yeah, I'm trying to work out whether that was a slow ball or not. The speed gun says no, 147 kilometers an hour would suggest that that's not a slower ball. So a normal pace delivery scuttling through from a good length outside the off stump. So if Scotland can get a score on the board here, they're looking very good for it at the moment. We're just seeing signs that it's not going to get any easier to bat on as this game goes on.
So the free hit missed out on. And here comes Wood round the wicket. That's a length delivery. Pushed into the offside. Moeen picks up. Good running actually between Munsey and Jones, because pressure was put on the fielder. And they couldn't get the throw in. 33 without loss. Again, full pace delivery from Mark Wood. Just shy of 90 miles an hour. And he's a little shake of the head down below us as well. Conference between Chris Jordan, Mark Wood, Harry Brooke. It's the Scotland flags at the moment that are flying with a little more enthusiasm around this ground. England thought they had the breakthrough. They're going to have to try again. Jones is on strike on 13 from 12. Scotland 33 without loss, winning the toss, electing to bat first, and Mark Wood is running away from us and exposing the stumps. Here's Jones. He's going to get a single towards Chris Jordan. Wood, as is his way, fell over. And a bit like a stranded goalkeeper reaching for the ball high over his head. He couldn't quite stop it as he lay on his side. So it's another onto the total, 34 without loss. England looking for that first breakthrough. Wood's going to go round the wicket again. There's a fielder at square leg. And also at fine leg. Those are the two outside the circle. Here comes Mark Wood. Round the wicket to bowl to Munsey. It's a quick ball, which is well defended. As that flew on through once again. Five overs gone. 34 without loss. So far, so good from a Scotland point of view. England looking for that breakthrough. They've tried Moeen, they've tried Archer, they've tried Wood. They're going to try Chris Jordan. We'll get the thoughts of Kasim Sheikh at the end of the power play in an overs time. But taking up commentary after some more thoughts from Stephen Finn, Nikhil Chandani is standing by.
Yeah, it's not quite panic stations for England yet. 34 for none from five overs, going under seven runs and over. But it's a foundation for Scotland to build on. And having seen a little bit of the variable bounce now, Moeen Ali getting one to really bite and kick and take the glove of Munsey outside the off stump. And Mark Wood there getting a couple to scuttle through low from a good length will give Scotland heart when posting a score here. So certainly in the game.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Finney. And one Barbadian replacing the other. Chris Jordan now from that Joel Garner end to bowl this final over of the power play. Here he is starting from over the wicket to Jones. Starts on a good length and just pushed into the onside. The positivity, Finney, from Scotland. Been impressed?
Yep, like it. I think it's been selective as well. It's not been wild slogging. It's been selective, waiting for the balls outside the off stump for Jones to punch Archer through the offside. Munsey waiting for Wood to err in his length and to flip him up over his head. So yeah, it's been good batting, strong batting in between that, trying to rotate the strike. It's been a good start.
Deep backward square, deep third are the two fielders outside the circle. Here's Jordan again, similar length. This has been smoked out of the ground, over the, on top of the Greenwich and Haynes stand, which is in the leg side. It was a short delivery and just picked up so quickly by Michael Jones. The shackles have been broken from his perspective.
That is a big hit. That's hit the solar panels. That might be a decent sized bill actually for solar panel replacement. Damage with the cricket ball, but it's angled in around the midriff of Jones. Chris Jordan just looking to keep the ball within the width of the stumps and bowl back of a length, but Jones completely expecting that, hits it on the way up. Absolutely mashes it out the ground, and that's running off down the road somewhere. A £60 present for someone.
Yeah, only 8 runs off the 2 overs before this one, so you feel Scotland just felt that they had to make use of this final over against the hard new ball in this power play, of course. And this is what England missed, not having someone like a Rhys Topley.
Yeah, a specialist power play bowler who's used to swinging the ball so potent in these first 6 overs. Might be ruined not picking him right now.
They've gone for the extra pace. Now, extra fielder deep leg side. So deep mid-wicket, deep backwards square. This time, pace off from Chris Jordan, but it's outside the off stump and it's pounced upon by Michael Jones with an offer and gets another boundary.
Yep, lovely shot. Again, very still when he plays it. So he's a big man with a wide stance, but as soon as he picks a line and length, the base with which he hits is very, very still. So it's full and wide from Jordan, attempted slower ball, he's able to pierce that gap with lovely timing.
Yeah, only a 70-20 international, Michael Jones. He's been, of course, occupied with his Durham commitments, but here he is now facing Jordan again, short and again pulled. This time though in front of square, so even though there's two deep fielders on that leg side boundary, he's still able to find the boundary. It's 14 runs from the first, well, from the last 3 deliveries.
Yeah, it's dismissive again. Such a still base. That's what I'm really picking up on when I'm watching him here. His eyes are level, his feet don't really move too much other than to align themselves with the direction of the ball, and just absolutely smashes this one through a straight mid wicket. It's commanding, and Chris Jordan's under real pressure here with 2 balls to go in the power play. 48 for none.
Captain Josh Butler has a word with him just in terms of plans, in terms of execution. But what a start this has been from Scotland, winning the toss, batting first. 2 deliveries in the power play. They're 48 for none. Here is Jordan, still over the wicket. Again goes back to that fourth stump line, driven in the offside, but well stopped at that backward point field position. It's Liam Livingston there. How do you see the middle overs going? Will Livingston play a part, you reckon?
Livingston will play a part. I'd imagine Adil Rashid is going to be swiftly introduced into the attack the next over from this end. Although saying that, I think he's just signalled towards Moeen Ali that he's going to be bowling this end. So maybe Rashid coming towards after the over after that. Rashid's going to hold. There's going to be crucial in the middle overs to try and take wickets.
Final delivery of the over and the power play. Here's Jordan, wide again. This time bit wider, right in front of that wide line. Doesn't time it well, but Jones is still able to rotate strike. It's been one of the main elements of his innings so far. He's on 29 from 19 deliveries, 49 for none after 6 overs, 15 runs off of that final over of the power play. George Munsey also there on 17. Great start for Scotland, who would have wanted to start to strike that first punch.
Yep, they came into it in bullish mood, didn't they? They said that they weren't here just to take part, they were here to play assertive cricket. They know they've got the players to be able to challenge teams, and they're doing just that. This has been a huge challenge for England.
And we know Kazim is also with us in studio. Kazim, you must be very happy with that.
I'm keeping my feet on the ground, but if there was a plan that we could have executed, 49 without loss after 6 overs in the power play, yes, I would have definitely taken it. And I think every Scottish cricket fan would have taken that. And, you know, this is going very much to plan from everything we talked about before the game. getting runs on the board. This is a really crucial time now, these next four or five overs. I expect Adil Rashid to come into play, and it's going to be really crucial how Scotland play him. We don't want to waste this good start.
Well, before Rashid, it's Moeen Ali from this Malcolm Marshall in. First delivery just punched into the offside by Michael Jones, who's off to a great start. And you expect Ali to bowl from this end because of that strong wind factor, which is actually coming from the southeast today, which is quite peculiar here at Kensington Oval. But you think about all the rain we've had around. The 50 partnership has come up in just 38 deliveries, but he spins the ball into Jones, making him hit, of course, into that smaller side. But to Munsey, will spin the ball away, and he's got to hit into a strong breeze as well as a 64-metre square boundary. Ali again around the wicket to the left-handed Munsey. The rain has just begun as Munsey is defending into the offside. I've got some reports, Finney, from some people in the east, and they say it's coming pretty heavy.
Yeah, you can see the towards our right here, which the groundsmen are pulling the covers on, but you can see it. The hills are disappearing in the distance, so this might be set in for a while.
Yeah, really unfortunate, because especially from a Scotland perspective, it's an ideal start. There will be some exposure to the rain now, but the ground staff just about getting the covers on quickly. They've got a reinforced team here at the Kensington Oval. I think it's about close to 50 individuals working across the duration of the tournament, but covers are on. A very strong wind, and very unfortunate that we have some overcast skies, and it means that the entertainment has been put to a pause. As they say, hello and welcome back to Henry. Just a short break for you, Henners.
Well, there we go. It's frustrating, isn't it? Because it is raining quite hard, but what we have got is, because we've had five overs of the Scotland innings, in theory...
There's a game.
England would only have to bat five overs and we'd have a game. So even if we... And look, there's a lot of time we can make up in this. So there is plenty of time. But if it rained for ages and we did start losing significant time, you know, we've at least done that side of it. And Scotland are in a really strong position here, Finn.
They're in a brilliant position. Well, they'll be hoping that they get back out there to play the full 20 overs, because clearly at 51 for none, it's a great start, and Duckworth Lewis would adjust itself accordingly, but it would still favour the team batting second if this were to be set in. So it's been a brilliant start by Scotland. I was really impressed with the way all of them spoke before the game, and Lees that we spoke to as well, or you spoke to in the build-up to the game yesterday, about how positive they were feeling, that they weren't going to be also-rans, and they were going to play assertive cricket, and they've done just that, and they've put England under big pressure here.
You can see how strong the breeze is that you mentioned, Nikhil, because they're struggling to pin down those huge white tarpaulins, and we did see earlier on there was a little bit of water that got onto the pitch as well, that added a 25-minute interruption to this game. But for our listeners in the UK, in terms of the weather at this time of year in Barbados, are we going to see this throughout the tournament?
Well, we hope not, but in June especially, which is the start of our hurricane season, it can be quite often where you get the rain, and especially in places like Guyana and Trinidad, where obviously England will hope that they can get to Super 8s and then compete there. But those two territories especially always get a lot of rain. In Guyana, I think it rains every day of the hurricane season. But again, because of that strong wind, it doesn't last too long. But what that rain factor also plays a part on is the dew factor. And you even saw last night in that Afghanistan-Uganda game, there was heavy dew formation, and it will continue to set in, especially in those two places, Trinidad and Tobago and Guyana.
Well, I think the rain might have actually stopped now. It was short and sharp, but what you've heard is that there's rain coming, more of it.
Yeah, I've heard from some people in the east, they say that it's quite heavy, those in St. Peter, where the rain will sort of make its way from. So hopefully this breeze can blow it. And that's the next thing, the wind is kind of swirling today, so you don't know sort of the wind direction and where the wind actually pushes those clouds. But right now it's coming from the southeast.
Yeah, and there is a little bit more rain. Kazim Sheikh, former Scotland batter, they'll want to get out there, no doubt about that, because they want to continue this momentum. But there'll be a real buzz in that Scotland dressing room.
Yeah, very frustrating. When I seen the rain coming down there, that was, and I can't imagine how frustrated the two batters are, because they'll have to start again. But I mean, big credit to Michael Jones and George Munsey to come out and look as composed as they have from ball one, and then take advantage of any width, anything short, anything about touch to full. Michael Jones has played some beautiful shots, and that over off Jordan has really given Scotland what they wanted from that power play, and they're in a fantastic position now. I just hope the rain stops.
Well, it's got harder, I'm afraid, which is the news that we can bring. It is absolutely pouring. And we have seen this over the last few days since we've been lucky enough to arrive, Stephen, that when it rains, you know all about it.
Yeah, so it was encroaching on my hotel room front door, I think, the day that I arrived here. I dropped my passport in it as I got out of the cab. Scrambling around in the rain, getting soaked, trying to pick that up. And it was running a river. So when it rains, it really properly rains here. And it does look pretty set in out towards the right. The hills that were easily visible when it was nice and sunny are just a bit grey and indistinct, aren't they, at the moment, which is not a good sign for us.
Well, there are some England and Scotland supporters that aren't worried too much at the moment because they are currently bobbing about very merrily indeed in the swimming pool on the beach.
Well, I thought it'd be quite fitting to send one of our team over there to report from them. Matt Henry, I think, would be the most ideal candidate to go down and do some live reporting with a roaming mic to see what the views and the thoughts of the people in the swimming pool are.
Well, he's off, he's gone, he's on his way. It's a brilliant place to watch cricket, this, Nickel. And do you sense that as the tournament goes on, it's going to pick up momentum? Or is it entirely reliant on success for West Indies as a host nation?
No, I think definitely as the tournament goes on, we host, I think, 3 Super 8 games here, and one of them could be India, another one could be Pakistan, and there's quite a big following for those teams in Barbados. I definitely expect Saturday to be a full house. Australia, England, that's going to be packed. But what I do enjoy and I'm happy to see is the government initiative to get some of the school children in. So a day like today, again, people sort of underestimate the impact watching a game like this could have on younger folk and the growth of the game for younger people. So I think them being able to be here, obviously not ideal that it's raining, but if we do get the full action today, to have these kids come in for free today, I think it was a great initiative and great just to get some atmosphere in the ground.
We spoke a lot about Jofra Archer and the build-up to the Pakistan series, the build-up to this World Cup. But it was quite a moving moment when he was at the end of his mark and there was the big cheer as his name was announced.
Yeah, he's beloved in this country. And as mentioned earlier, he gives a lot back to Barbados and the development of cricket here. And the fact that he could come in and, I mean, before he even played club cricket this last time, which was, of course, organised in a rehabilitation process, he was playing for Foundation, which is his former secondary school, in just a normal Saturday club game, which is probably our second best division here in Barbados. And just the fact that he would take his time out, didn't really have to do that, could easily just spend his time at home and try to recover from his injury. But he's so committed to sort of his roots and where it all started for him. And I think it's a huge moment for him, Chris Jordan, Phil Salt, those guys that have that connection to Barbados, and to see them here, and obviously they'll play some important games here, and hopefully for them one on the 29th. It's a great moment.
I'm sure you'd be really grateful as a local, except if you were batting.
For sure. And I mean, no one will want to see them. What we saw on this surface, it looks two-paced. It looks like there's some uneven bounce. And you've got those two guys bowling 150 kilometers per hour. You don't really want to face that because you just don't know how the ball will react. And credit to Scotland. They've picked Brad Wheel and Chris Soule, two guys who can similarly get up to that sort of pace. And who knows, 20 overs from now, what this surface could look like and how it could react.
Well, the score at the moment, 51 without loss, Scotland, early on in the seventh over. The reason that we're chatting away with no cricket is because the rain has been falling. It is just about stopped, I can tell you, but those ground sheets have got a lot of water on them, and we haven't even got the super sopper out there yet to begin the mop-up operation. They'll have the radars out. I don't know how easy it is to predict what the rain's going to do in this part of the world. It looks as though,
well, it's like it's brightened up so much in the distance, isn't it? They couldn't see the hills around 2 minutes ago, and now you can see them quite clearly. So it's a very quickly changing landscape, but it looks like we're having some positive news.
Yeah, it looks as though they are beginning to take the covers off, so hopefully we will have some sort of sense of when things are going to resume not too far from now. 51, as I say, on the board without loss, Scotland. England did think they'd got the breakthrough, but a no ball from Mark Wood, giving Munsey a second opportunity. So that is why, at the moment, Scotland none down.
Henry, I'm interested to get your perspective on Barbados outside of the Kensington Oval. What do you think?
I think it's appalling, terrible place. No, it's a spectacular place. Of course it is. And, you know, we went out for dinner last night. And actually, one thing that has really struck me is how many people are talking about the cricket and how many signs you see around the ground and around the island for this match, matches coming up, the tournament as a whole, and it feels like it's really connecting with the local population in a way that sometimes when you arrive, you do wonder if, you know, actually how much it's cutting through in certain parts of the world. But it really does feel like it is.
Now look, it's a huge tournament for the Caribbean. The amount of jobs and opportunities this tournament has provided all the way from top to bottom. I think even guys netballing, I have some friends that are 18, 19 years old netballing against England, against Australia, leg spinners, learning from Adil Rashid. I just think across the board, what it does for fans, people in the Caribbean, is huge to have a tournament like this. And credit to the governments, because they've put a lot of money and time resources into this tournament, into making it what it is now.
What difference does it make, Finny, when you arrive somewhere and you feel like you're arriving at an event? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, well, no, you do feel that when you come to a World Cup, because you've got all the merchandise, you turn up as a player and you're given your World Cup backpack, which with your name on it, and you've got everything's got its own special branding and logo on it, and you do just get a sense that there is something happening. And then, as you say, you go around the town, or you've gone to restaurants, there's cricket on a big screen in every restaurant that we've been to since we've been here, and you can just feel like there's something happening. And I think part of that in this country is also because I think the West Indies have got a real chance of going all the way with the team that they have, and with the public's support, you wouldn't bet against them.
Well, there is other cricket in the World Cup taking place today, I should tell you. Nepal against the Netherlands had a delayed start, but it is underway now. End of the first over. Netherlands winning the toss, choosing to field first in Dallas. Well, not field. Nobody chooses to field. You choose to bowl. It's for me, it's a misnomer, because fielding's the worst part of the game.
I think you're probably right there. Yeah, it wasn't my favourite.
So they've chosen to bowl. But they're 5 without loss. Nepal at the start of that game. Here, Scotland are 51 without loss early on in the 7th over. The last of the covers has been dragged off the field, which is good news. So it means we can't be too far away, because the umpires are going to have a look as well. Kazim Sheikh, former Scotland batter. We mentioned the little things like, you know, the tournament backpack, that sort of thing that players will get, and being part of the big event. But Scotland's development into a side that is established in playing not just in the qualifying tournaments, but more increasingly in the T20 World Cup as a whole. It's a real sign that the side's moving in the right direction.
Absolutely. It's becoming the norm now, watching Scotland play in the World Cup, and that's amazing as a fan and for all the followers of Scottish cricket. But what they're doing right now, live in this first game against England, is just a sign of what they can do. And I would just hope that they get more opportunities to do that. But beating England today, maybe beating Australia later in the group stages and qualifying, you know, it's amazing what that could do for Scottish cricket. I know I'm getting a bit far ahead of myself, and I'll continue to keep my feet on the ground. But after a start like that, I'm sure you're all thinking, you know, this is a really good side who know what they're doing, and they've got a game plan. And the more they get the chance to play at this level, sky's the limit.
We mentioned that game at the Grange, the ODI in 2018, a lot, not least because it's the last time that England and Scotland faced each other in any form of international cricket, and this is the first time in T20 cricket that they've faced each other. But those moments, those opportunities, they do make a huge difference.
They do, absolutely. Is there maybe an opportunity for a three-match series between two neighbouring countries in future? I don't imagine it'd be that hard to set up. I'd love to see something like that. Maybe a home and away series. I guess it all comes down to how Scotland perform in this World Cup, and so far, so good.
Indeed, 51 without loss is the score early on in the 7th over. Nikhil, you'll remember Scotland's victory famously over the West Indies in Hobart at the start of that last World Cup. And I have no doubt at all that caused a few ructions in this part of the world.
Yeah, I think that was the first sort of wake-up call or real panic for West Indian fans. And I remember it vividly, waking up very early in the morning, watching the game, and it was all Mark Watt. And coming into today, I had a similar thought about his impact, and obviously they're batting first. But with this win factor and the fact that England have just the one left-hander in their top six in Moeen Ali, he's going to be so critical. If they can get a big score or a decent score on the board, even if it's a par total, given how the ball has reacted to spin and given how potent he has been over the years against some really good teams, I think he can use that bigger boundary as well as the win factor and really take advantage of the situation here. So he was really good on that day, got through for 12 in Hobart, and yeah, they'll be hoping for similar returns, because after that win against the West Indies, they lost to Zimbabwe. They didn't really sort of fulfill the expectation after that win. So they'll be hoping for better returns, especially if they can win today.
We're going to restart in 10 minutes' time. That's good news. No overs lost. So this game is being delayed and delayed, but we haven't lost any time yet. Matt Henry from the BBC Sport website is with us as well. These early starts, they do mean an early alarm clock, but you also have plenty of time to make up for lost time.
Yeah, 90 minutes, isn't it? I think there's, strangely, which feels a bit odd for a tournament, there are more minutes available to make up time for these early games than they are the evening games. There's more time in reserve, if that makes sense. So I think we've got 90 minutes on these early morning starts. So we must be close to pushing that now, I reckon, after the, all the delays we had earlier. So if there's any more delays, we'll be close to losing all of us. But for now, we're fine.
Kazim, we've seen one ball from Moeen really bounce and cause a threat. That will be intriguing, Mark Watt and the Scotland camp, no doubt.
Absolutely. As we talked about in the toss again, Joss Butler has obviously played for some rain to come into play. I think Richie Beddington, the Scotland captain, has played for how this pitch is going to play. And it's clear to see, even with the faster bowlers, yes, the odd one goes through with bounce, but the odd one is kind of skidding low as well. And yes, Moeen Ali getting that turn and bounce was very nice to see, because I would hope that Mark Watt, for instance, in the second innings for Scotland, will equally be able to do that. And I think it's quite important to watch what the quicker bowlers are doing. They're not necessarily bowling that quick every single ball. They're starting to use a lot of change-ups, Jofra Archer especially. I'd expect the same thing from the Scotland bowlers, which is going to be tough to chase whatever Scotland are able to put on the board here.
Well, the good news is we're not losing overs, because 51 without loss after 6.2. Goodness, it's a brilliant start, this, for Scotland. They'll be thinking, well, maybe not the sky's the limit, but if they could keep going at their current rate, they're going to go well north of 150. And they'll have something to bowl at, and they'll have a little bit of pressure they can exert on England. Sorry, Kazim, that was directed at you. I should have told you exactly who that was going towards.
Sorry, could you repeat the code? I didn't catch that.
Of course, yeah. They're going to have, if they can keep going at this rate, yeah, in theory, this rate at the moment, as things stand, would take them to 161, but they'd hope to be able to push that a little bit more. I mean, they're going to have, if they can keep going, a little bit of something to bowl with and some pressure they could put on England.
If you'd asked me before the match, would I have taken 160 to defend? Yes, I would have. I think that would have been a very challenging total. Obviously, getting a little bit excited here with the start we've had, and you start to look further ahead. I don't want to get too far ahead of ourselves at the moment. I think 160 would be a benchmark now, and anything above that is going to be really, really challenging for England to chase.
I'll make one point on that, not to scare Scotland fans too much. Warm-up games are warm-up games before these World Cup. You can never take too much from them. But in the game against Afghanistan, Scotland's numbers 2-6 all made single-figure scores.
Yeah, that's a concern. That is a concern. That's why I'm not getting too far ahead of myself. And just let's just take each ball as it comes. But yeah, there is some concerns about the next three or four batters and what kind of form they're in.
Henry, can I give some concern to the English fans? England, I read yesterday, have never beaten a European nation at a T20 World Cup. Lost the Netherlands twice, 2 rainouts against Ireland. So come on, the Scots.
Come on, yes, Nico, I like that.
Well, there we go. Well, now we know where you're. Where you're.
There's too many Englishmen in this commentary box, man. We have to get some balance.
Thank you, Nico. Thank you.
Right, well, we did have a start plan, but now I can see a cover being dragged back on again. Is this going to be the story of the day? It's not raining at the moment, but the stumps are being taken out, and once again we have the potential for another frustrating delay. They've seen something coming, the ground staff. Hopefully this might be precautionary, but I can actually now see the other big tarpaulin is being dragged out as well. What have you seen to our right there, Nico?
Yeah, the problem is that we're looking, so what we can see over that grandstand, Henry, is the east. But today, the wind is blowing from the southeast. So actually in the corner of this stand is where it's really coming from. And looking there to my right, it looks quite dark. So I'm hoping that, you know, this could be the last. But just in terms of, you were talking about earlier, you have 5 minutes of heavy rain, then some sunshine, then rain again. It's because of that heavy wind that we get at this time of the year. So it's blowing the clouds across the ground so quickly. But again, we don't know how much rain is coming.
Well, at the moment, they've just paused in their process of dragging the covers across, which is good news. We want them to stop, turn around, and take them back again. We'll have to wait and see. I know that Garfield Sobers is here today. He's just been shown on the big screen, which is very nice, special, having somebody of his ilk watching on, and he'll be hoping that come June the 29th, he's seeing a West Indies side lifting the trophy at this ground. And we also hope so much that we don't have too many rain interruptions across the tournament, because it is so frustrating for all of those spectators, for the two Scotland batters who are desperate to get back out there and have had to head back into the pavilion. We were due to restart in 5 minutes from now, but I think we can safely say, given how many covers are being dragged on, that we are going to have another delay because of the fact that the rain must be coming. They will have seen something out of the back of this stand and know that we've got more rain to come.
Yeah, without getting too graphic, there's a toilet out the back of our commentary box. The toilet's there, and there's a window that looks out towards it. Nicol says we can't see from here, but you can see from the toilets, I'll tell you that. So having Finney tried to send me to the swimming pool earlier, if I could send him to the toilets to see what it's looking like out the back, because it wasn't pretty earlier. The weather, I should point out.
Right. Else. Well, that is an important clarification. Thank you, Matt. Because that is where the rain seems to be coming from, his bat sort of behind us to the right, the southeast. And you can see actually as they try and pin those covers down, it's almost as though, you know, you're trying to straighten out a bed sheet and you really pull at it. It's absolutely billowing across. And at the moment, we just have to wait very, very patiently. If you want to get in touch, by the way, tms@bbc.co.uk on the email, you can do so. Or a hashtag BBC Cricket. We're bringing you every ball of every game of this World Cup and all the details, everything you need to know via the BBC Sport website and app. And there's an email that's come in from Abdul that says, we'll love to be there. Is the ground full? More England fans, Scotland fans? Well, it's not full, but there are plenty, certainly in the Greenwich and Haynes stand over to our left. And I would say there's more England fans than Scotland fans, but there are plenty of Scotland fans, particularly there's a contingent behind us to the left of us, Matt, where there's a good number of Scotland flags that I can see.
Yeah, I know England, Australia is on Saturday, isn't it? And I know a few friends of mine are coming out this weekend. So more England fans are on the way is the feeling for that big game at the weekend.
Yeah, and just to build on, I think this rain, right, and Finney said earlier that he expects some upsets. I think some teams could really suffer because of the rain. If any game rains out sort of, and it's a big team against a team, maybe an associated nation that you expect them to beat, it then has ramifications for their for them to qualify. Because then, if let's say, for instance, this England game didn't play, they basically would have to beat Australia and hope in order to get through, because this is a game that they expect to win. So the rain could really be quite detrimental in this sport of cricket.
Yeah, it's always the factor that you bring into World Cups. Think about England against Ireland in the T20 World Cup in Australia last time. That was washed out. That caused all sorts of problems. And then you suddenly have to worry about winning games from nowhere that you thought perhaps weren't quite as high pressure. And then they suddenly become so. It has got considerably darker in the last couple of minutes. And they've pinned down the covers, though they've been fighting quite a battle, the ground staff, to try and do so. Because, oh, hold on a minute. One of them's blown away. There you go. Well, we said it was a bit of a challenge. And now there's a big argument taking place over who wasn't holding down their corner. Oh, umbrella's gone flying as well. And there's bits of litter that have started being strewn across the outfield. And look, the beach towels are going up. It really is picking up.
This is what you get in Barbados, a little bit of everything, you know. We just sprinkle it in, bit of wind, bit of sun. But England must be saying, well, what's going on with us? Because they just had that five-match series. They only got two games because of the rain. Then you think you're coming to Barbados full of sunshine, and now there's more rain again.
Well, there's a flag that's being waved by two supporters that says Sunny Scunny and Scunthorpe United underneath. It's anything but sunny here. I can tell you there's lots of England flags. There's a Leeds United one over there to our left. There's a one for the Barbados branch of the Derby County Supporters group. I'm not sure how big that membership can be, surely. One that rather curiously just says Stilton. But there's plenty of those football flags you see all around the ground. They're getting buffeted at the moment, because surely what is coming is going to be reasonably heavy. And indeed, it's not unlike the scene from Independence Day over to our right, as a huge, great mass is hoving its way into view. And I think we are going to see some fairly significant rain quite soon. England will know what they're chasing in terms of Duckworth Lewis and one thing and another, Matt.
It's always an advantage, isn't it, to know what you need in the situations. And England are stacked with big hitters, can't they? So they will back themselves, whatever the target is, to chase it. But it's, I don't know, it's just a frustrating sight. And England weren't really that good in that period that we saw. It's hard, isn't it? Judging team, what was it, 6.2 overs. You can't judge a team off 6.2 overs. But England, after what happened last year, and again, we don't want to keep going on about what happened in India last year. It was a different format, I suppose, although a lot of the same players. We England fans will have been hoping for, and England themselves will have been hoping for, a nice fast start of getting to the action early. Instead, what we got was a wicket off a no ball, a few missed fields, a few wide deliveries from Chris Jordan that got hit away for four, and he wasn't the only one by any means. So, yeah, let's see some more litter or a bin bag fly across the ground. I know the wind is definitely picking up, and the TV cameras are being covered with the tarpaulins down there as well to protect them. So some rain is coming, definitely some serious rain is coming, I think.
Yeah, I think you're right. Rachel's listening, saying, I'm listening to the rain in Barbados from a very hot and very dry Stockholm. Go on, England. Thank you, Rachel. Dan Collins says, the weather here in County Durham sounds identical to what you've got there. Sunny, short, heavy showers, a stiff breeze, just what I'm experiencing. You all know that part of the world, well, Matt. It's very much like Barbados. Oh,
the beaches, we've got it all. Yeah, northeast of England. It's hard to stand in Barbados and say it's the best place in the world, but Nicol's looking at me with quizzically, I'd say.
Matt, one thing I noticed, there's a lot of Yorkshire-born players in this England team.
Yeah.
What's up with Yorkshire and producing cricketers, man? International cricketers as well.
Big county, isn't it? Yeah, a lot of... Well, historically, I mean, you go all the way back to the start and England have had so many cricketers from Yorkshire. So, yeah, definitely. But Mark Wood representing the North East as well. So, yeah.
It is going to rain, and it's going to rain heavily. We know that because even though it is not falling at the moment, the big screen says play interrupted due to rain. It feels as inevitable as anything. As inevitable, actually, as Christopher in Berwickshire going to a Scotland game and it being washed out. He emails saying every single Scotland match I've had a ticket for in the last 5 years has been washed out. You'd think we'd be safe in the Caribbean. In Scotland right now, glorious sunshine. There you go. Inevitably, it's the way it works, and it's the way, as we've been saying, that for England, it's got really frustrating in the last few weeks that they've lost as much cricket as they had. But the good news is ABBA's playing, so that'll cheer everybody up around the ground, as it always does. Right then, we have got some live cricket that we can go to because it is no doubt about it going to be a delay here in Barbados. And we will have another interruption with Scotland at 51 without loss early on in the seventh over. When we get news of a restart and we get any details of when we might see some cricket, the rain has now started falling. We will, of course, bring it to you.
Just to say that Henry Moran, a BBC man out there with the England-Scotland game, he's just put a post up a few minutes ago. So if there's enough clear weather for a game, a five overs minimum, they think England would need 66 runs. But more importantly, I think, as I read this, he says, no certainty we'll get a game. It's still hammering down there. So that's the latest we have on the England-Scotland situation.
Just had an update from our man Matt Henry in Barbados. Says it's darker again in Bridgetown, that he's starting to get worried for the fate of that game between England and Scotland. Scotland had reached 51 without loss. Excellent start after they won the toss and chose to bat. They're in the seventh over when the rain came.
We're really frustrated by the scene in front of us here at Kensington Oval, where England have been taking on Scotland, but we've only had 6.2 overs of it. Scotland winning the toss, selecting to bat first, and they've got off to a really good start as well. 51 without loss is their total when the rain started falling. And as I say this, actually, covers are being taken off. They are going to have a look at this and see if we do have the opportunity for any play. In terms of a cut-off, that sort of thing, well, they need to have started again for a five-over thrash for England to bat five overs by about an hour and 10 minutes from now. So we've lost a lot of time. We won't see Scotland batting again. I think we know that much for sure. But we do know that if England do get out there, they're going to have potentially quite a stiff target to chase down. Were it to be five overs, we think it would be 66 runs they'd need from it. If it was six overs, it would be 77 runs that they would need to chase down. So at the moment, while we haven't got a confirmed restart time, we do at least have the covers beginning to come off. Stephen Finn is alongside me, as is Nikhil Uttamchandani. And as we've sat here over the last hour or so, it's been frustrating, Finny, but there are just signs we might be in the process of getting things going.
There are. The view out to my right is mildly concerning because the hills in the distance are disappearing. But we have hope. And it was a really entertaining start to the day, actually. Well, after the hour's delay for rain in the morning. But as soon as the game did get underway, it was a really good battle. Scotland really acquitted themselves very well in those first six or so overs, capitalising on a poor over from Chris Jordan to propel them to this score that they find themselves on now. At 51 for none, it's just been a great shame that the music has ensued all the way through, even whilst the rain has been hammering down, and you can see the Scotland players on the pitch down there tossing a ball about between them and from hand to hand. They're desperate to play this game because they sense that they're in a good position.
Nikhil, what do you know about the weather? There is certainly a lot about. Any local knowledge that could give us any insight?
Yeah, those in the east tell me, Henry, that it's still falling. It's still falling quite heavily. The thing is, though, it's very overcast here at the Kensington Oval, but it's not actually raining at the moment. So I wonder if the umpires are just saying, let's just take off the covers because they're going to need to get started soon with the cleaning up if they're to have that game restarting, as you mentioned, that cutoff time. So yeah, I don't know if you can really play given what's to come when I look in the distance, where you literally can't see past this layer of trees. But maybe the wind can take it another place, but as I say that, it's not really any wind.
No, it's funny, it has really died down, hasn't it? But you know, they will know, the ground staff, exactly how the microclimates around here operate, and the hope is that as they are taking off the covers, that one, it is not too damp underneath there, and two, that the weather that is coming may just dodge us a little bit. Also with us, ex-Scotland batter Kasim Sheikh, and when I mention those numbers, Kasim, the talk of 77 from six potentially for England to chase down, 66 from five, I mean, suddenly you're thinking, oh, that's quite a task, and could be a day of a famous, if slightly unusual victory for Scotland.
Yes, doesn't look, you would take those calculations. Takes me back to a game many World Cups ago where Scotland played a similar fixture against New Zealand at the Oval, I believe. Unfortunately, it was a similar kind of target and New Zealand chased it down. But, you know, I'd take it. I would be happy with it. But again, with England's batting lineup, you back them to chase anything down. But certainly, if Scotland could take maybe an early wicket or two, pressure would very much be on. And you never know. They're still, but it's not sounding very promising. Listening to Nicol there, who's got a bit more local knowledge of the weather, sounds like we could get some rain again anytime soon.
Yeah, and that's the worry and the frustration, because as much as it is, you know, having the rain stop, you've also got to allow enough time to clear things up and dry the outfield out too. Michael Jones on 30 from 20 balls, George Munsey 18 from 19. They weathered a little bit of a storm on the field as well as from on high, and played very well indeed, Finney. It was a really good start.
Yeah, it was, and they played with nice control, actually. I think sometimes when you're coming into a tournament like this, you win the toss, you bat, you feel like you have to make the most of those conditions inside the first six overs, because what we've seen from this pitch in the games that have been played here so far, that it doesn't get any better to bat on as the game wears on. So they executed the first part of their game plan beautifully, both batters hitting boundaries in their first over, or in their first five or six deliveries that they faced, seemed to settle their nerves, and they just looked calm and in control. And all of the talk that Scotland had and all the noise that Scotland were making coming into this game and in the build-up to this game was that we're ready for this. We feel prepared and we feel ready to throw a challenge towards England, who are one of the big boys of white ball world cricket, and we're going to go toe-to-toe with them, and that's exactly what they did.
Nikhil, your thoughts on what we've seen?
Yeah, I thought it's a partnership, an opening partnership that really complements each other well. You have Munsey, who plays a lot of sweeps, a lot of reverse sweeps, and we saw him take down sort of Moeen Ali in that over in the power play, but they have Jones at the other end, who's a lot more fluent against pace, and I thought they were very selective in their matchups, and you saw him take down Chris Jordan. So the way that they've sort of managed things, and it's not a very familiar opening partnership because it's only Jones' seventh T20 international. It's been Ollie Hears who's been at the top of the order with Muncie in the last 2 years, but it seems like the two of them have found that perfect balance, and I love the positivity as well. The running between the wickets was very good, and they seem to be that intent to score. Different conditions now, but yeah, I think they'll take a lot from that. And look, they'll believe they have got nothing to lose, Henry. They'll believe even when they come out to play Australia, regardless of what happens today, that they can win every game of this World Cup, well, in these first four at least.
Well, I can see the England players are gathered on the boundary, eagerly awaiting news on that balcony, I should say, up above. Where the umpires are heading towards now, though, in the pavilion. So Garfield is here today, by the way. The words that we can see being exchanged between umpire Nitin Menon and the Scotland coaching staff, I wonder what they are saying is, OK, 10 overs, am I guessing that, possibly? The fact that we are guessing here because he has put out two hands with fingers splayed towards some members of the Scotland team. I mean, goodness knows, until we get official word, we can't possibly say. Might be 10 minutes that they want to start. We'll have to wait and see. But it looks as though things are happening, and we'll get news of this pitch inspection shortly. But Finney, this is encouraging. More encouraging than anything else we've seen for a while.
Yes, it's just been heavy rain and grey skies, isn't it, for the last couple of hours, whilst we've been sat here up high over the top of the ground in the media centre watching what's going on. But yeah, it's exciting. There are things happening. You always get a sense that people are becoming more urgent when you're sat up here watching the Scotland fielders. A few of them are catching balls. The Muncie is out there with number 93 on his back, ready to have some throwdowns. So it feels as though the start is imminent, and I would imagine that they've also got half an eye on the weather that's to come.
It is imminent enough that we know when it'll be. 2:10 local time is what we're hearing. So 20 minutes from now, 10 overs per side. What I haven't had confirmation on is, are Scotland going to bat again? Presumably, it's not quite clear from what we're getting whether Scotland come out and bat for the remaining 3.4 overs, or whether England will have 10 overs to chase down a revised target. I don't know.
No, both teams would have to bat the same length of time, wouldn't they? I think. So I would imagine, 10 over a side game,
But looking at the cutoff time, how would there be time for that? Floodlights have just blinked on. Well, we'll get confirmation of that shortly. But
I think all this, Henry, just begs the question, why win the toss and bat first? Given all the weather conditions around and all the variables, now obviously England have a big advantage, regardless even if it's 110, which it will not be. But even if they have to chase 110 in 10 overs with 10 wickets in hand, you're pretty much the chasing team that wins 9 out of 10 times. So yes. Yes. Tough one for them.
Yeah, I'm going mad, Finn. You're right. They'll play 10 overs per side, is what we know from that. And Scotland will be back out with these two in a moment. So that's interesting to see how they approach that.
Well, it's going to be... So if it's 10 overs a side, Wood has already bowled 2, Archer's bowled 2, Moeen's bowled 1.2, and Jordan's bowled 1. So Adil Rashid will bowl 2, almost certainly. Moeen will finish the one that he's currently in. So then there's one over spare. Chris Jordan's one over went for 15, but he is there almost specialist death bowler, and you would imagine with his experience would be entrusted to bowl that final over. So it would be interesting as well to see that they've got the quick boys out the way. Muncie's a very good player of spin. He likes sweeping. Adil Rashid will look to bowl googlies across him, but a couple of big slog sweeps, and if he gets a couple of them, that score then starts running away a little bit. So yeah, Scotland will try and have to make the most of these 3.4 overs. There'll then be a revised target, won't they, to take into account the fact that Scotland played the first 6.2 overs thinking it was a 20 over game. So I'm glad my brain doesn't have to compute and calculate those.
I just find that my brain goes to mush when I have to think about these things, because you're thinking, well, where were they at that point in the innings? How do they calculate that? And it just does get complicated. But
I think you have to really enjoy numbers to do that.
You do. Where's Andy Zaltzman when you need him? So Kazim Sheikh, what do you make of all of that? Former Scotland batter, 51 without loss. There'll be 3.4 overs to bat, and just give it some from the Scotland side.
Yeah, I kind of like the first part where it was looking like maybe five or six over bash, needing maybe 66, near 70 runs. This is a big ask now. These next 3.4 overs are going to be crucial. They literally have no time to come out and think about it. They have to go big straight away, because I agree with Nico as well that kind of 100, 110 and 10 overs, England will fancy that with 10 wickets in hand. So I don't know what's a good... What's a good target now for Scotland to get to? You'd think they'll have to get somewhere near 120 which is going to take. No, sorry, that's going to take some going. I keep forgetting now. There's only 3.4 overs. I'm also not very good at my calculations in these things.
This is where Duckworth-Lewis comes into account,
yeah,
though, as well,
definitely,
doesn't it? If they get 40 off these four overs, I think it would be revised to 120. And given what we saw here the other evening with the medium pacers and the spinners getting that variable bounce, anything that Scotland can muster together here, it's not going to be a simple chase. 109 was tied on this surface, this exact surface, the other day off 20 overs. So yeah, any score where England will have to come out and be super aggressive, I don't think that's going to be a foregone conclusion.
It's also slightly confusing looking at the scene in front of us, because the warm-ups that are taking place have both sides bowlers going through their various work, because normally you're ahead of a game at this point with 15 minutes or so to go, you're quite used to seeing the rhythms of things, but both sides are sort of having to reset from the off, aren't they, because they've been off the field for a couple of hours now, and so there's a lot of work to be done.
Yeah, well, it's mentally, it's actually exhausting days like this, because you're looking out the window until it fully filled in, it felt as though you were going to be off and on, and the groundsmen were pulling the covers off and then putting them back on, and it's really hard to mentally switch off in those passages and then come out and turn it on straight away. So there can be a bit of a hangover from those breaks in play. It's going to be up to both these teams and the support staff to steel their minds so that they're fully focused when it comes to the first ball.
Yeah, it's always a challenge, isn't it? Because you're also aware, Nicol, that the way the weather's been over the last few days, and I'm sure is, as you said, at this time of year, you're always aware that, well, when's the next delay coming and what's that going to do and how's that going to impact things? I mean, you have to approach it with what you're given, but it is always just there in the back of your mind.
Yeah, and watching the groundsmen and their sort of body language, they're not really going anywhere, so I think it could easily come again, and one more big shower could put an end to this game, so we hope it doesn't. I think what has helped and given the umpires optimism is that wind factor that kept blowing the clouds across the ground has disappeared. It literally is so still outside, so because of that, they felt confident enough that it wouldn't come, or if it doesn't, if it comes, maybe not within the next hour or so. So look, I think as Finney said the other night, it was on a similar pitch, on this exact pitch and in similar conditions. What we started at 10:30 or 11 o'clock, it was bright sunshine, Muncy and Jones were batting in. Now it's quite dark, the lights are on, and you just don't know sort of impact that little sprinkle of rain has had on this surface. There's been no sun to dry it out, so it's been under the covers for the last 2 hours. Let's see how it goes.
Yeah, it'd be really interesting to see. And it almost feels like it's about 7 at night, doesn't it, with the floodlights blaring down and the fact that, well, it feels like we've been here a long time as well, because it's only 5 to 2 local time. But we have seen cricket from all times of day so far in this competition here already, with the match the other night finishing beyond midnight. So then, what are we expecting, Stephen, in terms of how England approached this and who's got overs left? I'm not sure who can bowl. Yeah, I would have thought that Wood, Archer and Moeen will be bowled out now. So
yeah, they'll be done. Moeen will complete his over. He's bowled 1.2. Rashid has 2 to bowl, which he'll almost certainly bowl on this dry surface. And then Chris Jordan is the one bowler remaining. They could go Livingston, but I'd imagine it will be Rashid, then Jordan, and then Rashid to finish.
Yeah. In terms of Scotland, Kazim, and who might be pushed up the order to try and give it a bit of a biff, who are we looking out for?
I think they've got to look at Michael Leask, the chap that you had on the podcast yesterday. He is definitely Scotland's biggest hitter, I'd say, after George Munsey at the top of the order. So I think they have to consider getting him in next. He definitely can clear the ropes. So that's what I think they'll be strongly considering.
Yeah, so there is potential power to come. And it's always this interesting thing, isn't it, Nicol, when you see a match reduced like this, how teams with such clear plans and scenarios built for all eventualities, they have to really start scrambling to work out exactly who's going to do what, those matchups, those dreaded matchups once again, all of those things.
Yeah, and this is why you love T20 cricket, I think. It really is so hard to pick a winner a lot of times. That, yeah, we know England are probably in an advantage position, knowing exactly what they'll chase, having 10 wickets in hand, but as we've discussed, you just never know with the adjustment that will come after the 3.4 overs. You never know how Scotland will come out. If Muncy can come out and have a big over now and to sort of make use, or maybe a Michael Jones, make use of that matchup against the off spinner, ball spinning into him, hitting into the smaller side, there's no win factor anymore. You just don't know. All of a sudden, yes, it's a very strong England batting lineup, but this is a World Cup and there will be a degree of pressure on. two early wickets in the first over, and it's a whole different game.
Yeah, England have never beaten a European side in T20 cricket. Let's not forget that weird statistical quirk, and it feels as though the weather gods are doing their best to try and ensure, or certainly that they were doing their best to try and ensure we wouldn't see a completed game today. We are going to see a restart in just over 10 minutes from now. Scotland 51 without loss. Stephen, what will the conversations in that England dressing room have been? Because it was not perfect in the field.
No, I think there would have been, I mean, there'd be no berating, there'd be no aggression or anger, I don't think. I think they'd recognise that they were a bit off the pace. There were a couple of sloppy misfields. Mark Wood took a wicket with a no ball. It didn't look clean out there, which when we watched Namibia here the other evening, they looked like a real slick unit, diving around in the field, zipping the ball in over the top, catching and stopping everything that was in the vicinity of them. So there'd have just been a couple of words from Joss Butler and Matthew Mott to say, let's just make sure that we're 100% on it here and we're concentrating right from the very beginning. If we do that, we should be all right.
Yeah.
Yeah. One thing I'm noticing, Henry, I've seen this a lot today, Kieran Pollard and Matthew Mott having quite an engaged discussion. It happened before today's play as well, and just hearing from some of the England guys, they're quite happy with his presence. I think we're seeing the West Indian guys, the former players that is, and coaches in these various setups making a big impact. I look at last night, Dwayne Bravo with Afghanistan, understanding conditions, and even Papua New Guinea, who have got Phil Simmons. Some of the plans that they bowled to Nicholas Pooran, for example, Andrew Russell, it was quite strategic, and it was almost like they had some sort of inside air, which they did. And Phil Simmons obviously coaches Pooran in franchise cricket. He's coached the West Indies. So I think Pollard's influence on this England team could make a big difference going forward in this tournament when they play in the various venues.
Well, it was almost the key signing. It felt like that. And the psychologist back, the Manchester City psychologist back, who was a part of the thing and the whole setup in 2019 when England won this trophy, or not this trophy, forgive me, the 2019 50 over World Cup. Kasim Sheikh, what will the Scotland feeling be, do you think, at this point in the game?
I think it'll just be such a tricky situation. I'm sitting here trying to work out in my head what's the best way to go, what kind of total, and I don't have all the answers. I think what they'll start with is they've got 10 wickets in hand, and to go out hard and try and get as many runs on the board as possible, and see where they get to, because they're going to need every single run possible. And then I think the plans will be very much shifting. They'll probably be talking about it already on who's going to bowl when, because obviously now everybody doesn't have the full contingency of overs that they can use. So who's going to be, you know, how am I right in saying, will that then work out as five twos? Will it be two overs max? How are the overs going to work? I'm still trying to work out all these calculations.
Yeah, I'm sure that'll be the case, because it actually does make things a bit simpler. If you just half the match length, it'll be five twos.
Yep.
And presumably a power play of three overs. So that I don't know, because bearing in mind they may alter that, because Scotland had the advantage of six overs of power play, and England, in theory, could argue that, but they will probably calculate that through Duckworth-Lewis. So all of these things that you wait for at this point. Yeah. What's happening in a dressing room at this stage? You're just waiting for all of those.
Well, you're waiting for the numbers. That's the first thing that the coach will be saying. You want the denominations of bowlers. You want to know how many overs and balls you're going to get in the power play when it comes to your turn to bat. And you just want to make sure that you've got absolute clarity in everything that's going on before you go out there and start delivering your skills. So that's the analyst. It's not the coach's job. You've got managers who go up to the match referee's room to make sure that they've got all of the stipulations to make sure that everyone understands it, because it can feel chaotic. 20 minutes ago, they'd have been sat there looking at the grey skies in the background with the covers fully on, drenched in water, thinking, we're probably a good chance of this being called off. And then within 15 minutes, they're all out there warming up, mentally having to switch on with a game of World Cup cricket on the line.
And these are all of the challenges and pressures that come with tournament cricket. And tournament cricket, let's not forget, Kasim, that Scotland and their players are so well drilled in as a unit, because to get to this position, as we keep on saying, they've had to play so many matches where everything's been on the line.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I got a vision there of the two opening batters. I'm just super impressed with how they've managed to keep their cool through all of this, because it really is so difficult. Finney's talked about it a few times, mentally being able to switch on and switch off. Both of them look in the zone. They look ready, and they look ready, set to come out. And hopefully continue in their merry way as they were going already. But I mean, Adil Rashid is going to make it very difficult to get away. But it's I'm nervous here right now. I feel like I don't know how they're so calm, because I'm not that calm. And good, fair play to both of them. And I think the batters that come in after that are just going to have to be as switched on as possible, because it might just be the difference that they score off a couple of balls, and that might be the difference in this match today. So, yeah, this is exciting stuff.
Finny, if somebody who'd never seen a game of cricket before was presented with this situation, who would you say has the advantage?
I think England actually have the advantage now that the game's been shortened. It all depends on what Duckworth Lewis does, because I think they updated the system recently to take better into account T20 matches, because I think the same system was used for 50 and T20 for a while. But I think that there's been a recalculation and a recalibration. But I still think Scotland are in a very good position. They just need to try and push this score up in these 3.4 overs and be as aggressive as they possibly can, use the fact that they still have 10 wickets in hand, hope that Duckworth Lewis does them a favour and makes it a target that's challenging for England, take a couple of wickets. But right at this very moment in time, with two overs of Adil Rashid left to bowl as well, I think I'd rather be in England's camp. But a lot can happen.
Yeah, well, I'd be very interested to see. I think the first 6-7 balls could be really telling, and this feels like it could be quite significant. Earlier on today, we were asking where the weather was and where it was coming from, and I mentioned that there was a flag in the crowd saying Sunny Scunny for Scunthorpe, and we had an email from Leon and Lewis in that very part of the world saying, trust me, it's raining in Scunthorpe as much as it has been in Barbados. Scunny, definitely not sunny today. But Nicholas Rowe emailed earlier on, tms@bbc.co.uk, saying, I'm in Lapland in Finland, 20 degrees, bright sunshine expected for the next couple of months, almost day and night. We've had frustration here today, I think it's fair to say, in Bridgetown, Barbados, where the skies overhead are leaden, but we haven't got those clouds scudding across quickly, as we saw earlier on in the day, that sense that there were storms moving in the whole time, and it was just a matter of time before you'd catch one. It does feel more settled now, and we do have a restart in 5 minutes. So as the England players gather on the boundary edge, and the two Scotland not out players, Jones and Munsey, also wait to come back into the action, there'll just be the sense you've got to get the game heads back on, and that can be difficult. You look out at this ground, Steve, and you see people dancing around in the sand.
The DJ's revving everyone up, isn't he? I'm ready to go take my top off and go down to the beach, I think. Revving them up into a frenzy down there. But the players, they just have to try and switch on. Joss Butler will be there. There'll be a small huddle. And the message in that huddle when they do step over the boundary rope will be, let's be right on it from ball one, because you can't waste any time in a game where there's only 3.4 overs left in your bowling innings.
Reminder, if you want to follow the second innings of the game between the Netherlands and Nepal, that is currently live on the BBC Sport website and app. The Netherlands chasing 107 after 3.1 overs. They are 16-1. They need 91 to win in 101 balls. Right then, here are the playing regulations and conditions for the second inning. Match reduced to 10 overs per side. The power play will be 3 overs, so it is just a power play chopped in half then. Scotland to resume, as we know, at 51 without loss. The final target for England will then be revised by DLS. 5 bowlers can bowl a maximum of 2 overs, and because Wood and Archer have bowled 2 apiece already, that means we will not see the England fast bowling duo bowl again in this game. Moeen's got 4 balls left of his second over, and then Chris Jordan having only bowled 1, and Adil Rashid will take up the rest of the work. So unless England do something really funky, Liam Livingston perhaps, but it feels like that's the most obvious way things will go. And here come the England side then, dashing onto the field with the floodlights beaming down. You didn't expect that at 2 p.m. Here in Barbados. We thought it would be sunlight all the way, but it is not that time of year here, Finny, and so we're having to make do with getting on with this game any which way that we can. Kasim, some thoughts from you in terms of what you're expecting, what you're hoping for from the remaining 3.4 overs of this Scotland innings.
Well, I think we have to target these last 4 balls. I don't think there's any time to play yourself in. I think they will look to go after Moeen Ali. for the remaining four balls he's got, because there's a daunting task of facing another two overs, as has been discussed already, from Adil Rashid. And I think the over from Jordan has got to, you know, he got targeted in his first over, so I think they're going to look to go hard against him again. And I just hope they get as many runs as possible.
We shall see. Thank you very much for the time being. Myself, Henry Moran and Stephen Finn. We'll be taking you through the next 3.4 overs, with England looking to restrict Scotland and Scotland looking to hit as many as they possibly can. We will not know what England will be chasing until after Scotland have finished batting. I mean, that sounds incredibly obvious, but there is a nuance to that, in as much as it won't be simply one more than Scotland scored, because it will be Duckworth Lewis revised, because Scotland, of course, not getting their full complement, and they would have batted in a different way, etc., etc. But they have batted very nicely so far, and we are going to see George Munsey there on 18 from 19, and taking strike Michael Jones, who's 30 from 20. And often at a moment like this, you forget who was on strike when you went off the field. I actually think it was Munsey, but at the moment it looks like Jones is going to face the next delivery.
I'd like to think the umpires have got that one right.
You'd hope so, but there's a little bit of a delay, because it isn't actually quite 10 past. It's just ticked past 9 minutes past, and so we can't start yet.
We need to wait for the countdown, don't we?
We do need to wait for the countdown. Or do we? Because we've already had the countdown once.
That's true. My guess is we'll be getting another one.
I would have thought so. We've got fielders in the deep, with a deep mid-wicket, a deep cover out there on the boundary. There's long off, long on, deep backward square leg as well. And finally, I think we are ready to go. It's going to be Jones on strike, the right-hander, under grey skies here in Barbados, with Scotland 51 without loss. This game reduced to 10 overs per side, and it's going to be lively the next 3.4 overs, because Scotland have just got to get on with it, see how many they can possibly get. Here we go then, Moeen Ali under the floodlights with his off-spin, and forward comes Jones, and immediately a dot ball played back towards the England all-rounder Moeen Ali, with the long sleeves. He turns in those red boots, and we'll move in past umpire Nitin Menon to bowl. The ball outside the off stump, slapped towards cover. There'll be a shy at the non-striker's end. Will there from Best? Oh no, they'll scramble a single. 52 without loss. It's almost like after a long train delay, seeing that scoreboard just tick forward one more, no longer saying 51 without loss. It feels very satisfying. It's, I feel like you're moving again. Moeen, round the wicket to the left-handed power of Munsey. Very good on the sweep. He does go into the leg side. He's cleared the wicketkeeper, Joss Butler, and the ball drops rather gently towards Jofra Archer running round from short third. Single is taken. He was trying to repeat the trick of those boundaries into the leg side. He can't quite do so. One hand off the bat, not a controlled stroke. They do get a single, 53 without loss. So just two added from the first three balls since resumption. And Moeen moving in once more over the wicket to bowl to Jones, slapping that ball out to deep cover for a single. Phil Salt will collect in front of the Greenwich and Haynes stand, which has been packed full of England supporters and school children as well throughout the day. And so with three overs remaining in this reduced Scotland innings, 54 without loss, just three added in those four balls, Stephen Finn.
Yep, and well bowled by Moeen Ali, actually, drifting it outside the off stump, really slow to the batters there, to Jones in particular. Jones advancing down, looking to try and hammer it into the leg side, but Moeen saw him coming and just kept drifting it and dragging it slower and further outside the off stump. So it's a good start for England, only three runs from it, and now the master has the ball in his hand. You'd imagine there'll be some purchase, even with the rain that we've seen. This pitch is still going to spin, and one of the best spinners in the world has the ball in his hands.
Yeah, Adil Rashid, who quietly and brilliantly has been such a vital cog in this England white ball side over the years. Leg spin from the far end of the ground. This has been hit back down the ground. It's a nice looking shot, and that could be six. I think it is, yeah. Jones with a mighty heave back over the bowler's head and slapping into the advertising board. 60 without loss, Scotland.
Yep, lovely controlled shot again from Jones. He did it before the rain break. And now he's come out here full of a length from Rashid, a bit quicker. Out the front of the hand, pushed through. Jones pounced on it and hammered it straight back over Adil Rashid's head.
Rashid again into bowl to Jones. This has given more pace outside the off stump and hit cover for a single. Jones moves to 39 from 25. Scotland, 61 without loss from 7.2 overs out of a maximum of 10. This game, rain reduced.
Russia!
So far, since the resumption, just a one boundary, but it was quite an authoritative one. Munsey on strike. He's 19 from 20 as in comes Adil Rashid. Big heave into the leg side. Oh, there's an appeal for two things there. The LBW and then possibly, if not that, then the potential that there's a little bit of bat on that as it balloons up to Joss Butler. Immediately, Adil Rashid is making the symbol that he wants to go upstairs. Phil Salt's come in from cover to have a conversation, and Joss Butler is indeed going to send this upstairs for a little look.
Yeah, Adil Rashid's done the Stuart Broad there. Yes, Captain, it's definitely out. Definitely review it. I'm not convinced.
To the umpire director, we have a player review for court. The original decision on the field is not out. I've checked the feet, it's a fair delivery. Front on, please.
Sounds like he's eating the microphone.
Doesn't it? That's Joelle Wilson who's looking after things with some fairly vintage broadcast technology by the sounds of it. Right, let's have a look at this. First viewing. I'm not sure that that's hit.
Not sure if there's any bat there. Could you give me ultra edge, please?
I think that has bounced up off the pad and then hit the forearm. Here comes ultra edge.
Flat line. Keep going. Yeah, it's a flat line. And I want you to take it out for me. So as it hits the pad, let's see it come out. Flat line. Go right out. Right, I have nothing on ultra edge. So he's not out court. The ball has hit the pad. The original decision is not out. Can you bring up ball tracker for me, please?
So now they'll check the LBW.
That's a frustrating element of the DRS system.
Standing by for ball tracking.
It's a completely unnecessary check of ball tracking, isn't it?
And also, should you not need to specify?
You should stipulate, yeah. You should have to stipulate what. You shouldn't just be able to throw all your chips in. You have to stipulate
ball
what you're reviewing for.
No, original decision is not out. The ball is pitching outside leg.
Just by foot.
Your original decision.
Yeah.
I'll let you know
the sport that's trying to speed itself up.
Your original decision, you're on screen.
61 without loss then. Here comes Adil Rashid to bowl to George Munsey, who tries the reverse sweep, and he's connected nicely with a full toss. That's a one-bounce boundary. Hit away over what is, in a conventional stance, cover. But I think he was distracted, Adil Rashid, by seeing Munsey moving into that position, then bowled a rank full. Rashid into Bolter Munsey, who again tries to clear that front leg with the reverse. And I think he might have got six for this. He does. And Scotland fans are dancing with delight. The Sultars flying. Joss Butler wears a concerned look because this over has gone for 17 so far, and that is a brilliant stroke.
Yeah, smooth. He turned around a touch later this time, actually. Adil Rashid trying to hide it outside the off stump, but that just gives Munsey more opportunity to throw his hands through the ball. And he's absolutely nailed that. It's landed on top of the dugouts. Six.
71 without loss. Here comes Rashid. This time it's down the leg side, swept firmly, and just about retrieved down there on the boundary by a tumbling Liam Livingstone. And so the over comes to an end with 18 from it. And Scotland, 72 without loss with two overs left of their 10. And we spoke about how important it could be to get a big over. Well, the good news from a Scotland point of view is that they've done exactly that, Kazim Sheikh.
They have, and obviously I was concerned about how they would play Adil Rashid, but George Munsey has pulled the reverse sweep out, and he's the first one he hit fairly well. The second one he's absolutely smoked at, which would be over extra cover for him, but yes, almost like he's hit it over mid wicket. Yes, 18 runs off Adil Rashid's first over. Do England bowl him a second over now? And the pressure is very much back on England. As many runs as possible off these last two overs, please.
Well, that's the question England will have. Rashid was your banker.
Yep. Well, yeah, he was. The others had bowled out. Wood, Archer, Moeen's now bowled out. Chris Jordan is bowling this over. Big decision for Joss Butler. Does he go for the finger spin, maybe, of Liam Livingstone to the left-handed Munsey to be able to push it through and into the surface to stop him playing those shots? But Six balls of Chris Jordan here to get through first before he has to make that decision.
Jordan went for 15 from his first over. He's bowling from the Malcolm Marshall end below us, runs away, and Munsey swings violently, misses. If he'd connected with that, I think we would have been fielding it. But he doesn't get anything on it, and that was quick from Chris Jordan, close to 90 miles an hour. You forget with Wood and Archer in the team, actually, that that Jordan himself bowls at some rate.
Yes, he can. He's upped his pace in the last couple of years, Chris Jordan, as well. He's a very fit man, he's a very strong man. Always working on his body, working on technical bits and bobs with his bowling. That's why he's had the longevity that he's had. It's good pace, first ball.
Here comes Chris Jordan again, right arm over. Munsey is whipping the ball away into the leg side and for six. Again, heading out towards those dugouts. And a huge hit that brings Scotland a 78 without loss. And Jordan slaps the turf in frustration. And those Scotland players are up and about in that dugout as well, they might be.
It's a brilliant shot, and you know that Munsey is going to go crabbing across the crease, sets his feet outside the off stump to be able to shovel it up over deep backward square leg. He's got such strong wrists, that's the way he's able to play those sweeps and reverse sweeps, and also how he's able to hit the ball so flat over deep backward square leg off the front foot.
78 without loss, 10 balls left for Scotland. Here comes Jordan, one hand off the bat again as this is worked into the onside. They'll turn for a second that isn't there. Good work from Bairstow, who's so quick out in the deep. And Scotland move forward to 79 without loss. Jones will be on strike on 39 from 25. And don't forget, whatever the total is after 10 overs here for Scotland, that won't be what England are chasing. It'll be a little more than that because of the fact that Scotland's innings got chopped in half, and they were, well, going along nicely early in their innings. They would have approached it differently had they known it was a 10-over match rather than 20.
I think it might be a decent whack that gets added on as well. I don't think it's not going to be an inconsequential amount of runs, I don't think.
Especially none down.
Yes, none down. They'd laid a platform to be able to capitalise, and I think it does take all of those things into account. So it's going to be well over 100 runs. Well, they only need 21 more from the next nine deliveries anyway.
Here comes Jordan to bowl to Jones, who plays the ball into the ground. That's well bowled by Chris Jordan. Top of off stump, not much that the batter could do with it. Seven from the over so far. Yeah, there'll be, I think, a few nerves in that England camp at this point.
Definitely. It's almost, not worst case scenario, but they'll be scrambling around a bit at the moment, and they'll need a very good start with the bat when they come to it. But they've got eight more balls here of their bowling innings that if they don't get those right, it could be done and dusted at halfway.
In comes Chris Jordan over the wicket to bowl to Jones, who struck on the pad, and the ball will drop into the offside behind square to Mark Wood, and they'll trot through for a leg by. But He was trying to hit it out towards the party stand. He didn't get hold of it. 80 without loss. Really good noise around the Kensington Oval. Though the skies overhead don't exactly tell you island paradise. Out towards the beach where those jet skis lie. And I can see Wilmer and Fred Flintstone have been having quite the afternoon with the rum punches.
They've had a good crack at it, haven't they? It's probably about 4 hours longer than they anticipated being here.
Right, Munsey on 37 waits for Chris Jordan, who's about to bowl his final ball of the day. And he's running in now past umpire Nitin Menon. It's a low full toss, which he jammed down the ground. Out towards Jofra Archer, who scampers to his right to pick up. They'll get a couple of runs, and the throw comes in. I tell you what, he could be out here, because I think that bat's got jammed in the turf. The throw came in from Archer, direct hit, and they're going to have a look at it.
I can't work out. He looks. He's taking his gloves off. He looks as though he might be in trouble.
Give me your best side on, please.
It's raining again, by the way. Chris Jordan and a little high five with Mark Wood. It's not raining hard. It's not the sort of rain they'll go off with at the moment, but we'll keep an eye on it. Let's see the side on angle. Here we go. This will tell us all. I think his bat might have got stuck as he ran it in here. It has. And is his foot over? Yes, it lands.
Foot's grounded beyond the crease. I have a decision for the big screen.
So Joel Wilson will tell us not out. Eventually. Every little delay you feel is just potentially taking away the chance of what could be a brilliant game of cricket. This
would be fantastic. I can't wait. I just pray that this rain stays off, because it's going to be a truly fascinating second 10 overs.
82 without loss with an over left, and we are going to see Adil Rashid bowling once again from the far end of the ground, the Joel Garner end. Here comes Adil Rashid now bowling a ball which is spanked back down the ground for a single towards wide long off, and Harry Brook will get Munsey back on strike. 83 without loss. It's that sort of fine rain that if you weren't playing you wouldn't come out and play in, but when you're out there they tend to stick with it. Joss Butler looks around, sees his field spread with now mid on coming up inside the circle, so just wary of that sweep. There's a backward square leg and a deep mid wicket as Munsey switches the hands round and misses out, because Rashid tossed it rather wider when he saw the movement from the batter, and so a dot ball so valuable with four left in the innings.
It's been quiet since that six, exactly six balls ago.
Munsey waiting for Rashid. He's hit it hard into the leg side. On the bounce, it'll be collected out there in the deep by Livingston. One run taken. He punches his bat, does Munsey, because he feels that was there ripe to be hit away. Sure, it's 84 without loss. They need a boundary, you feel. Just a little bit of momentum. Scotland side that have done so well in this innings. Jones is on 40. Here comes Rashid, and he hits it firmly down the ground and will only get a single. Again, a batter looks frustrated. It's this time Jones who's chastising himself for not pulling that away. Field moves round for the sweep-dominant Munsey. Two balls left of the 10. In comes Rashid in the gloom of Bridgetown. Outside the off stump, and it's a horrible hack with reverse hands as the throw comes in from Chris Jordan towards the non-striker's end. Misses. The batter had actually given up the run. And with the ball left, it's 86 without loss.
Yeah, it's been a good over from Rashid. Learned from the mistakes of the previous over. He was trying to fire it in quicker. And that gave Munsey the pace to get up and underneath. He's been much, much slower. This set of six.
So in comes Rashid. And then he stops, sees the batter moving around and decides to abort the approach. Jones on strike on 41. Both have hit 41 so far. Can Jones finish with a bang? Four from the over so far. Final ball of the 10. In comes Adil Rashid now. Bowls a ball which has been hit firmly into the leg side and for four. On the bounce, one bounce. Out towards that collection of England flags as if just to underline Scotland's outstanding performance from their 10 overs. And so 90 on the board from 10. It will not be a target of 90. It will be more than that. We'll wait to see what the calculation is. But it has been a very good effort indeed from both Munsey and Jones. And here come the covers, whether it's precautionary or what, I don't know. But if they're happy to play a moment ago, it's not got any heavier. They should be happy to carry on playing now. And here come the big covers as well. And Nichols back alongside us. Oh dear, this is frustrating.
Yeah, it looks to be quite concerning as well, because they're going for the stumps, which means that the covers are coming on. They're not just keeping it close, but yeah, really, I think Scotland have a fantastic opportunity here, Henry, to win this game. 90 on the board and 10. It will factor in that they've not lost the wicket. And again, just the overall approach, it's not easy to stop and start in different conditions. Bit of variable bounce. It's been very good, this approach.
So, we know that for a five-over-a-side game to be completed, they would have had to have started that at 2:52 local time, which is 25 minutes from now. So you can add a little bit more onto that. I think we've probably got an hour to play with here. But it's barely raining, is it? It's not raining heavier than it was when they were playing.
Yeah, it's a drizzle, but I wonder, so exactly what you said earlier in terms of it's not enough rain to for you to go off, but if you're already off, is it enough rain to prevent you from coming back on? That will sort of be the big question, but certainly the players don't look too concerned. Scotland going through their paces, catching, but one thing about them, the body language, they look upbeat. This is a real good opportunity for them to continue what has been a worrying trend for England against European sides.
Well, one scorecard is suggesting England might need 109 from 60 balls. We'll wait for confirmation of that, but it is going to be something north of 100, I'm sure of it, and that will take some getting, it really will. And so I think at this point Scotland will be very happy indeed. Kasim Sheikh, former Scotland batter, you've seen a real strong performance from the Scotland side so far.
Fantastic performance. It was a pleasure to watch both batsmen. I'm so impressed with the way they stop-started, even the long delay at the start of the game. Then they stop-start again, they came out, and I thought they batted really, really well. Jordan bowled a good 19th over, which pulled it back a little bit. But that over, from the first over from Adil Rashid, has really given them the impetus to get up close to 100. I'm now very curious to hear what the revised target is going to be, because they hadn't lost any wickets. But as 109, is that looking like it's going to be the case?
I think that's what it's going to be, yeah. But the covers are coming back on, so we may yet see another revision. It might be from 9 overs, 8 overs.
Who knows? How's the weather? What do you think? How much more is it looking like? There's a lot of rain still to come, or is this a passing shower? What's it looking like?
Well, dare I say it, because the wind has died down, the fact that the rain is falling now means that it's going to continue for longer, you'd have thought. It is 109 from 60 balls. That's what we're hearing.
Okay.
So that is what we're looking at, should they get back out there. But the covers are being dragged on once again, and though Scotland continue their warm-ups, at this point, they're not going to restart, Nicol.
I want to ask you, Kaz, what do you think Scotland would rather? To have an opportunity to defend these runs or take the 2 points and play it safe?
Oh, come on. Come on, Nicol. Scotland, that's why the boys are out in the turf. We've got a big chance here. Big, big chance that we want to get out there and play. We'll bowl on those. We'll bowl on the covers if we have to. Whatever it takes, but I think the boys will be. You don't get opportunities like this often, and I think they'll want to get out there and definitely play.
Feels that way to me, because they're in a brilliant position, Scotty. 109 needed from 10 overs. It's a bit not easy, that, for England, and particularly with the pressure and the fact it's been off and on and everything else. But we're not going to start imminently, because the covers have been hammered down. And again, it's got very gloomy out there. And I turn to your meteorological knowledge, Nicol, and see if you can offer any hope.
Yeah, it's not looking good, because I just got a message saying that there's more rain coming. So again, it's hard to say because of how the sky has looked pretty much all day. And the problem is, if you look pretty much to the north, it looks quite good. Clear, obviously, it's overcast, but there's no rain clouds. However, where the rain comes from, which is southeast today, not looking good. And the flags are completely dead, which means that there's no breeze to sort of move this. And if it's this constant drizzle, I think if they were still out there, Henry, they would have been playing.
But then play now. What? I've never understood that.
I guess they're saying, well, if they go off, there's just the rain, the pitch is just being exposed to the rain.
But it was being exposed to the rain when they were playing.
Yeah, that's true.
Get them out there.
The umpires were stopping the batters and the bowlers. Yeah, I don't know. I have no explanation, but the covers are on.
Yeah, they are, and they're not going anywhere at the moment, certainly. Though Scotland continue to go through various catching drills and various other bits and pieces out there in the distance, and so we still wait and still hope for good news. I mean, I don't know about you, but it feels like we could be on the verge of being denied a quite brilliant game of cricket.
I know, it would be. I'm keeping positive thoughts at the moment. It would be an absolute gutter if that was to happen. So I'm going to keep positive for now. Although listening to Nicol's weather update there, it didn't sound very promising. But you know, weather can change quickly, and I'm keeping my fingers crossed that it does clear and we do get out there, because yeah, we will be robbed of what potentially could be a really, really exciting match between these two sides.
One thing I think we can say unquestionably is England have not been completely at it today, Nicol. I don't think they would be the first to admit that they've not been 100% on their game.
Yeah, a few misfields, and again, it's tough. Just like it is for the batters, it's equally as tough for a fielding team to sort of break rhythm so much. You expect to have a 10:30 start, then you start a bit later. Was impressed with Wood and Archer. I wonder how much they can sort of sustain the pair and the duo. Or is it maybe at the sacrifice of Chris Jordan? But watching Rhys Topley bowl here at Kensington Oval in 2022, watching him bowl in the Caribbean end of last year. The win factor and the amount of swing on offer, I think, at some stage he's going to be a very important member of this team. Obviously, another option is to have Sam Curran in the side who can bowl a few with the new ball, but I wonder how they sort of see their bowling attack and the structure, because I'm sure at some stage Topley's going to get that opportunity.
Yeah, I saw his dad, Don Topley, downstairs in the media centre earlier, which is always a treat. Don here as well, watching Sun Rhys in this World Cup. We'll wait and see what role he does play in the tournament. What we can also reveal is, even if this match is washed out, which we hope it won't be, but were it to be, it certainly is not remotely terminal for either of these sides in terms of their qualification hopes. It's not quite that dramatic. It just makes things a little bit more awkward, because you missed out on the opportunity of a win, and so the number of points you can get is that much smaller. So you will have to add a little bit of import to the rest of the games in the group. So that is what we're looking at, and as we're looking at the pictures as well, from what we can't see at the moment, which is what is behind us, and it is very grey and settled in. And because of that, though a notional 109 from 60 balls is required for England in this rain-reduced match, I sense that if we do get back out, it's going to be changed once again. So the calculators will have to be reintroduced.
News reaching us that the match has been abandoned in Barbados. Rain ends play, so England and Scotland will take a point each.